backstory for this too. In terms of like how long it took us to watch it.
Hello everyone, looks like we're live. It's The Drinker here, and I'm joined this evening by, what the fuck have you called yourself in this one, Mauler? And Rags and Metalcommander, and I wanted as many people as possible in this tonight, so I don't have to think too much about this fucking movie.
Whoa, no spoilers. People still think that it might be good.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, it's all part of the revelation, you see. We won't tell you right away. You're going to have to tease out the truth. But if one of us lies, then we'll instantly vomit, so you'll know. But yes, we are gathered here today to commemorate the end of Rian Johnson's film career. With the delight that was Knives Out. We all watched it together the other night, and it was quite the experience. How did you guys find it?
I was shocked. I was shocked and because odd. Many people have told me it was good and or it was okay. I found that neither of those represent the movie accurately.
Yeah, I was rolling my eyes a lot. As someone who's watched Poirot and even Monk, you're just like, this isn't actually, this isn't very good, is it? This is really kind of like, fuck, I can do this. If I just have everything rely on coincidence and conjecture, then fuck, I can do this. It's not that hard at all.
Just vomit a scenario onto a plate. And then connect it somehow. That's how it felt to me.
There you go. The thing that I always expected, I guess I expected to be a bit more surprised by it. I mean, Rian Johnson apparently prides himself on subverting our expectations. And so it's like, okay, you know, you're going to take this really well-worn genre of the whodunnit, you know, that Poirot-type cozy mystery, and you're going to put some crazy new spin on it that we would never see coming, and it's going to be at least something quite adventurous and different. But what you actually get is just a really pedestrian, by-the-numbers murder mystery. You know, nothing was remotely surprising about it. You've got every cliche under the sun, you know, the idiosyncratic detective that's been brought in to try and solve the case. You know, all the family members who've each got a motive, you know, a big country mansion where, like, you've got a timeline of events that they have to establish and a mystery over how it was all accomplished. It's just all stuff that we've seen a million times before and done better.
It sounds so much more complex and intricate than it really is executed. I feel like so much of what we learn about the characters is just pointless. And yep. in a kind of movie like this, kind of story like this, a lot of that is to present. I mean, a lot of the information that you get turns out later on that it wasn't, you know, relevant in any way. It wasn't useful. It didn't mean anything. It was just to try and lead you on. But none of these were like red herrings that were interesting, that you sort of attached yourself to, that made you think it could be this person. Well, it was all just a waste of time.
So many, like, they work really hard in the opening, like, 20, 30 minutes to be like, everybody's got a full motivation, and the height of the drama of that motivation happened all of the same day because Harlan decided that he wanted to cut them all off, I guess, figuratively. Well, in some cases, literally with, like supportive money and stuff.
Harlan's the person who was killed, so.
Yeah, he's the old one. You have all these, like, big events happening, and all of them don't actually matter at all. It's all actually something different. I guess you can say, you know, everything to do with Ransom is the fact that he's cutting off his family, so.
Yeah. I mean, did you get the impression as well that there was just way too many characters in this? Like, there's really three or four who are actually relevant. The rest of them are just there.
We really need to know that little boy is an alt-right troll on the internet.
He was probably the most misplaced out of all the characters because he barely has anything. He's literally just to represent a frustration Rian Johnson has on Twitter.
And we needed someone to have a wank on the toilet so he can hear, "I warn you."
What do they say? He's like, "Oh, he wanks to dead deer." And it's like,
yeah, okay. It was really funny.
This movie's not funny at all, by the way.
Yeah.
It's about as funny as Ghostbusters.
Oh, no.
I just want to laugh at something in the film. I think. It was when Michael. What's his name? The
Michael Shannon.
Shannon, that's it. It just cuts to him with the grandma going, "You want to eat? To eat."
Yeah, just Jamie Lee Curtis not come along? It's like, yeah, she just ate the entire salmon buffet or something.
Yeah. So yeah, I don't even.
Yeah,
know.
We were saying there should have been far less characters who were far more well fleshed out, developed, and potentially could have actually done it. Because yes. There's not enough screen time, given how many characters there are, to really get us feel like they were either capable of doing it or that we could believe that they were doing it. And turns out, your guess was probably correct the whole time, because it's really kind of clear that they're setting someone up to be a big character. And so the reveal was absolutely no surprise at all.
Yeah, you expect the black sheep to be the red herring, and it's like, no, it's just him. And you're like, oh. Okay.
Mm.
Yeah.
Well, how it goes.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just trying to think how to even begin, you know, breaking this thing down. Like, how do we kind of establish where it goes wrong?
It all starts with Harlan's desire to cut off his family because they're all assholes, basically, and they're
all of his family are terrible.
Yes,
all they of them, are, yeah. Every single one, to almost a cartoonish degree, they're all horrible people.
Money, they're cheating on each other. They're using his fortune for their own like benefits, I guess I should say. And you've struggled to be like, wait, so who do I like?
No one is the answer.
I think this is part of the problem. One of the many problems is like when you have this kind of murder mystery thing, you establish a varied and interesting cast of characters, and some of them, fair enough, can be unlikable and kind of despicable, but others should be likable and sympathetic, so that you've got a balance there, and you've got like a doubt over who potentially could have done it, and then you can play around with people's expectations of, you know, the really sympathetic person might be
the killer
after all. Yeah. Or you could double bluff it and the one of the less likable characters actually is it, even though you would have discounted that initially because it's too obvious. You know, you could do millions of different things, but with this, it's like Rian Johnson was trying to say, look, basically if you're rich and white and stuff, you are an asshole and you deserve to lose everything. You didn't earn anything that you've got.
Every one of them are fucking ridiculous. I guess Harlan is a nice enough guy. It's just we don't have enough context for everything to really know. Like he's being kind of an asshole to all of them, but it's like, oh, I guess they deserve it. I don't know. You know, Linda, played by why have I forgotten her name? Jamie Lee Curtis. What was what did Harlan hate her at all?
No,
I don't think so. Right.
She had, because she kind of prided herself on having made her own fortune. I can't remember what her industry was, but whatever it was, like she'd built her way up by herself, supposedly. But then you find out later on that she got
I think it was.
Yes, and then she actually got a loan from him of like $1 million to get started or something.
Yeah,
so.
But the house goes to Martha. It doesn't go to her. Why wouldn't it go to her?
Yeah, just because someone gives you $1 million as a loan, by the way, not free money. It's a loan. Mm. And then you turn that into a very successful business. Like that takes skill and that takes intellect. That's not something everyone could just do.
He didn't even hate his son, Michael Shannon. Like I can't remember the character's
Walt,
name.
But Walt.
Walt, yeah. Because he was more like, look, you know, you've been toiling away for years. Like just for context in chat, like Walt is like the guy who runs his publishing empire. Like, Harlan is like a famous author and he's really successful, and his son Walt is the one who runs all his book publishing business, and he's been doing that for a long time, I guess successfully. But then when we get to like the night of his death, he basically fires him, but he doesn't do it for malicious reasons. He's more like, look, I want you to have freedom to pursue your own interests, like to be an author yourself and do what you want to do, because I can tell you're not happy with this. So again, he doesn't dislike Walt, I don't think.
I don't think so either. It just sort of adds to the idea that all of this stuff happens on the same night.
Yeah, for some reason he decides to do all of this on his birthday party, like during the party.
He describes it to Marta as like a plus. He's like, I cut the four of them off. Like, yes. And it's like, well, wait, but Walt, like you explained, it's like you're the reason that you know, he's in any kind of a bad place. In fact, it seems to me that he's been doing a great job with what you wanted him to do, and now you're just like, lol, no. And then he's like really pleased about it, but in a more like I got revenge sort of way.
Right.
Yeah, he does seem to get a sense of satisfaction from it in a way, though I wouldn't say weird. It's like malicious, but
of course the guy who married his daughter who's cheating on her, that one I can totally understand him being like, yeah, fuck you
yeah,
up.
Yeah, Richard. Yeah.
And the person who's stealing money, Joni, the Tony
right,
Collette's
again,
character. Yeah,
she's not even a blood relative. She comes across as more of a parasite, I guess.
So she Walt's wife. I'm trying to remember.
No, her husband was Harlan's son who died, she says.
Ah, right, okay.
A big family.
Yeah. Yeah, I was going to say, as you could probably guess, like, there's a fuckload of characters in this movie, and
yeah,
it becomes difficult to keep track of them initially.
Absolutely. I actually think it's a bit of a fuck-up movie that I don't know most of the characters' names after the first watch, nor how they interact. I'm like, I can't remember which ones are his sons and daughters and which ones are the ones that are married to the sons and daughters.
Yeah. And it gets even worse when you get to the...
yeah. I can't, like, by the way, remember the girl who Marta is friends with? Do you know whose daughter she is?
Meg's. No. Isn't she the daughter of blonde chick, Joni?
Blonde parasite girl. Yes, I was question. I was just like, it's kind of hard to parse it out. Do you know who?
Because I have the cast out. I have the list of the cast out on another window to just remind myself of who's who and all the fucking characters in this movie.
The alt-right Nazi. Do you remember whose son he
is? That's Walt's
yeah,
son.
He's the son of Walt. But I can remember faces, but names I just can't. I'm not good with names anyway, which doesn't help me. But yeah. I do remember faces, yeah.
To be fair, we can pretty much discount the grandkids because they are totally irrelevant to the plot.
Well, except for when she leaks that her mum is
Meg. Yeah, Meg, yeah. So everyone in the family's terrible, except even the little Nazi kid is actually, he doesn't do anything bad in this, I can't remember.
Well, I think he only says that he heard them talk while he was having the wankaroonies on the toilet.
Which is, but this is after he's been killed and the will stuff has happened, and what he found out was that someone was upset. So, I mean, he doesn't actually do anything bad. I can't remember.
Well, he just throws out insults. That's it.
Oh, okay. He's just But Meg, she gives up that Marta's mom is illegal alien, which is a huge asshole move if they're supposed to be friends, because it's established that they're buddies. Marta and Meg are buddies. So she's a terrible, shitty person from that friend perspective. However, her mom should be deported. She's here legally. She did nothing wrong.
Well, that's fucking in the movie, actually, isn't it? That conversation. Mm-hmm. And then I think the movie is like, good-hearted people deserve to be in America.
and I think one of the weird things about the film that's kind of tied into that aspect is that Marta is so pure. She's so wonderful.
Oh,
so
she
talented.
Is... This lass is as pure as the driven snow. She, to the point where she can't even stomach a lie.
All right, we gotta go with this.
This is fantastic. So I'd love to know so much of this film hinges on the premise that Marta cannot lie, and if she attempts to lie, she will vomit spontaneously.
Not even that. If she is around a lie, if she hears someone tell a lie. She
I don't know if that's
can't
clear.
Even. Well, she says she can't even stand to hear others lie, doesn't she? I think so.
The way that they explain it, you could interpret it that way, but that's never banked on in the movie at all. Like that's not something that comes up.
Marta's so pure as a person that she, if she was to tell a lie, her body would reject the evil, one might say, and she would throw up because she can't lie. And that's what gets Daniel Craig, our detective, to kind of attach himself to her and use her as his...
Well, that's what we guessed, but yeah, I don't know if that's true.
Well, it's because he saw the blood on the shoe.
Yeah, that seems to be the film's reason for doing it. I thought the reason was the fact that he could use her ability to not lie to his advantage.
Surely he would anyway, either way. Because both of those two...
He doesn't use it. Remember, the few times after he puts her with him that he could get definitive information from her, he doesn't pay attention to whether she throws up.
That's because he lets her just go away whenever... They let her do whatever she wants.
So it's not about that. He doesn't even seem to care about that.
Yeah, he's kind of a shit detective.
Yeah, which is something I'm okay with, except for the fact that they introduce him as like one of the world's greatest detectives, and everyone knows his name. Like,
yeah, he's referred to as the last of the gentleman sleuths. You know, he's
terrible. So So the way the film tries to make him look good is by putting people who are even worse around him. Now, you've got a murder in a house, and there's a secret entrance, or let's just say a different pathway to get to the house that the cameras can't cover, and there's footprints all over it, and the police didn't check that in the first week, and he only checked it because he happened to notice a footprint there. He was like, oh shit, there's a footprint. This is something. It's the most embarrassing police work in that film ever, and it's all because nothing works if you have police who know what they're doing.
Yeah, see, so much of this film, because obviously, like any whodunit, it's kind of convoluted, but it relies on so much contrivance and so much coincidence in order to function, because I think this is kind of the hallmark of Rian Johnson. I'm starting to realize when it comes to his writing, he writes himself into corners, and the only way he can get out of it is to just use the most ridiculous contrivance and the most ridiculous made-up stuff that he can do, and that's why you get a movie like this, like the fact that you know, you've got a line about Hugh did this, but it relies on a character being named fucking Hugh,
I think that needs full context, right? So
yeah, I don't know if we need to start like at the beginning and kind of work our way through it,
or that one's just possibly the stupidest part in the film. I'm not sure. There's a couple of stupidest moments. That one's one of the big ones. Yeah, this is actually pretty hard to unravel in a way that's going to make sense. This is going to sound like crazy talk to people who haven't seen this movie.
But it's true.
Count yourself lucky.
The really high-level premise is that Christopher Plummer, who's like the head of this family, he's a very successful author, is found dead in his study. And Daniel Craig is like a special investigator who's brought in to try and figure out what happened to him, whether it was suicide or whether he was murdered. That he's got a big family of people who are all potentially suspects, so it's your standard whodunit. And the housekeeper and who's also like Christopher Plummer's close personal like assistant and nurse, she's there to assist him because she can't lie, and she actually knows a lot more about what happened than she's initially letting on. So that's the initial premise of it, and yeah, I guess all of it just revolves around figuring out who was responsible and how it was done.
Like, basically the police have already been there for a week and they know nothing. They like got nothing. And yet, we find out over the course of the next few days, there's a plethora of evidence to work with. Mm-hmm. They didn't check the security cameras, which will tell you something incredibly important if you look at them. They didn't check the footprints to the outside of the house. They didn't check the outside buildings. They didn't check the secret way into the house, which, fair enough, they may not have known about it, but they would have seen the broken, you know, piece of wood if they'd just looked. It was the dog that had to make Daniel Craig aware of that, which it's just flabbergasting, like some of this stuff.
Week later, they haven't done a toxicology report on...
No toxicology report. They don't find the dry mud because they're stupid. They didn't check... The fact that the medical bag was in the room was not taken in for evidence. Because really anything was.
Because when it comes to the toxicology report, that would be something that Harland would know they would do from the get-go, which makes the whole plan...
So like, we're going to...
Yeah, because Harlan is...
Key moments that the entire story falls apart, and I'd say that's the first one. Harlan is poisoned, technically, but 100 milligrams of morphine is going to kill him in 10 minutes, but he loves his helper so much that he immediately decides, fuck this, I'll kill myself, because if you kill me, you know, it'll ruin your life. He doesn't mention the fortune at that point, but that's obviously on his mind too. I'm willing to admit that. But Harlan being, if you remember this, this is me trying to best explain how this fucking problem. Do you remember how, what's his name? Chris Evans knows about toxicology reports and Rian Johnson. We thought that was just fine that someone would know that. But Rian Johnson thought that the most people would expect that to be ridiculous. Like, how could someone possibly know?
Yeah. Like, when someone dies, especially someone who's taking a lot of medication in their old age, they'd be like, oh, let's see what's in their blood. This could have been medical related.
That's and they have obvious. A throwaway line for it. She says, how do you know that? And he's like, I worked for Harlan for research for a summer. So basically, like, Harlan would have been writing a story about blood toxicology related report thing in the story, and Chris Evans had to research it for him to get it into the story. Now, that means that Harlan is not only a human being who would be aware of that, but he's written stories about it too. And for some reason, he didn't think that when he kills himself, which means he won't even be able to process the morphine in time, so it's just going to be there in his blood, pretty hardcore, that would just destroy all of it. It's like, how is anyone going to avoid this? You're like, oh, he cut his throat. It's like, yeah, but he's filled with morphine. Something else happened. Like,
also, remember the bag.
Yep, the bag was left there. Nobody
yeah,
cared.
They didn't. An old man taking medication dies under mysterious, supposedly suicide circumstances. In the room, there is an open medical bag that the nurse has left. They don't take it for evidence, which allows our killer to just go and get it and do stuff with it.
Yeah, that's
and Harlan can't know. So, he doesn't have any morphine in his blood because, as far as he knows, he got just nuked with 100 milligrams of morphine.
Yeah, and I would say that's where the film first destroys itself, but we've got like 17 other examples of
that. for the people in chat, anyone who hasn't seen it, so he has been accidentally dosed, as far as he knows, with a huge amount of morphine that's going to kill him within a short space of time by his nurse. She didn't mean to do it. He knows that she's going to go to prison if she gets caught and implicated in this, so he gives her a whole bunch of instructions of things that she needs to do in order to avoid being incriminated so that she can cover her tracks and make it seem like, you know, she was nowhere near the house at the time that he died. And one of those things that he tells her to do is to put his clothes on and to walk downstairs.
So that
Harlan's son, Walt, who's out on the porch smoking a cigar, will think that he's there at, say, 12:30 or something like that, long after she's left.
How did he know that would be happening? Does he always take a cigar?
I presume he's a creature of habit, perhaps, and he's always there. But this relies on his son, Walt, not turning around to actually look at him or talk to him in any way.
Yeah, he has to be out there on the porch still. He has to be in that location. He has to turn around, look through the glass. And it's very, very like, ooh, lucky that all of those things lined up and happened the way that you wanted it.
No one else was around. I know it was late, but still, risky as fuck.
Was there even like a second person on the
outside? Walt's son was there on his phone, I think, as always.
So double lucky, nice.
Yeah, so this relied on Harlan knowing that Walt would be on the porch facing away from the window. And that he wouldn't turn around and try to talk to Magda in any way. He would just assume that it was his dad there trying to come down for like a midnight snack or something and just tell him to go back to bed. Wait, so that is a fuck ton of assumptions right there.
Which Harlan would have said, fuck off. I'm having a sandwich. It's my house.
Yeah, exactly.
Like Harlan doesn't make shit for people, so there's no way he'd just be like, "Oh, okay, never mind, back to bed."
He just got done with a scene where he berates Walt, and like it was described by the other character as Walt being like a wounded puppy throughout the rest of the night, and then Walt gives his dad commands later. It's like, I don't think so. That doesn't seem right.
If I saw Harlan turn up the stairs after being told that, they'd be like, "What's wrong with him?" To just do that. But the whole his son being outside at that spot, who happens to turn around and look through the window at that time, just long enough to see her dressed as him coming down the stairways at that place. It's such an insane coincidence.
How much of a habit can it be, though? Because they're only in the house because they're celebrating his birthday. Like, normally they're not there.
I mean, I don't know why they were there for that long.
Are they? Are they were staying there?
Yeah, because you see that I think Jamie Lee Curtis gets woken up several times during the night by
people
moving around and stuff.
Wait, so does the whole family live in that house?
No, they don't live there, but I think they're just staying there for the party. They've traveled there or something.
That's how I had sort of.
Yeah, all I guess it is then is that apparently they do go out to the porch at 12 every night. He has a smoke and the kid just sits there on his phone, I guess.
But that doesn't even work either because he's not normally there. This is a special occasion. Like, they're probably there for one night only, and then they're going to go home the next day. What the fuck?
I don't understand how that works.
He knows his son that damn well.
It's such a useless step.
Well, the whole point of it, for anybody in chat who's confused, is that Marta leaves, quote unquote, then she sneaks back in and pretends to be Harlan so that she's in the clear. If she's been seen leaving, and then Harlan is seen alive after she's left, then she couldn't have been the one that did it. That's the logic. Even though, and this is painful, the police officers at the beginning of the film talk about who could have been motivated to kill him in the family, and one of them just says Ransom and Marta had both left the party at this point, so it can't be either of them. It's like, that's not how that works.
No, it can't come back. Once you leave, you've committed.
Yeah.
Such a social faux pas to come back after.
The other thing that he instructs Marta to do is that, you know, is to drive out of the grounds of this country house where there is CCTV cameras covering the entrances. Now, he says if you drive off the road at a certain point, you won't be seen, basically, and it'll look like you've just left completely, whereas you can just pull off the road and then run back to the house to do what you need to do. Unfortunately, she fucks it up and pulls off at the wrong point. Now, the police know that there are CCTV cameras covering this place, but they don't bother to check them at any point during the investigation. Yeah, because he's such a mega brain that he thinks, oh, we should probably look at this footage. Maybe there's something useful there.
This is what I mean. He's such a mega brain. He suggests normal things and looks really intelligent for it. It's like, that's not how this works.
But Marta then, because wouldn't you know it, Marta happens to be there with them reviewing this footage.
Oh, wait, yeah.
She realizes because she pulled off the road at the wrong point, she's going to be seen and everyone who's watching it is going to know it was her car that pulled off the road and they're going to know that she came back. So she fucks up the tape and makes sure it incinerate somehow inside the VCR?
Okay. That's like at least two things.
I've watched that tape scene 5 times just to try and understand it. It is so bizarre. So this is, again, people who are confused, right? So Marta is picked up by Daniel Craig to be her, like, just follow him around. It's confidant. He's going to have her help him. And we find out by the end he did it because he knew she was involved. He saw blood on her shoe. He knew that she was going to have something to do with it. But he was sure she was, he even says it when he first talks to her about, he's like, what does it take to be a good nurse? Is it a good heart? It's like, what? And the other cops are like, huh? And he's like, that's irrelevant. It's fine, dude. Moving on. So, like, I think the implication is he was, like, convinced she was a really good person, but that she's involved, so he just wants to keep her around. I don't really know. It's really strange because he doesn't really pay much attention to her, despite knowing that she's definitely involved. And this is why you can't really argue it. Like, she destroys evidence right in front of him, and he doesn't either notice or care.
Yeah.
And it's baffling because it gives you a lot of information. But, yeah, so she's with him. They go to the security tape room, and the guy is there, and he's like, yep, I usually delete or clean the tapes by hitting them with a magnet, which I think is a really weird thing to say, because they're VCR, you know, just VHS tapes. You can just record over them.
You don't have to delete them. It's not like they have gigabytes of storage that you have to delete before you fill it up again.
That's really lucky they never upgraded their security system, and they're still running on VHS.
Like, I would challenge every single person, and that includes us four, who's ever used VHS to record shit. Did you ever clean the tapes and then record something? Or did you end up with stuff where it'll fizzle sometimes and you'll see the old thing you recorded in the middle of the new thing? You'll be like,
always record it over.
Yeah, everyone does. Nobody does it the way you said.
And also, you can only record like so many times over it before the tape just breaks
or
becomes unusable. This it's not like you can go now and just buy VHS tapes. Like, they're not easily available. So this guy in this security shack has just been apparently for years just you know, recording his footage and then wiping the tape with a magnet for whatever reason, and then just recording again and again and again. Like, that would never work.
Yeah, a VHS tapes, VHS can hold about 4 hours at the longest of footage.
His holds 8.
His holds 8? Damn.
Yeah.
It's a special tape. It's
the Blu-rays VHS tapes he has there.
Still. It was funny as well, because I remember having problems being like, I wish 2 movies would fit on VHS. They really did, but not quite.
Do you remember, like, at the end of, if you used it for recording movies, like, you would get to the end of, say, the movie you'd recorded, and then there would be, like, the last 5 minutes of another movie that was on before, and then, like, some after that, like, random advert breaks and stuff. It was great. You never knew what you were going to get on an old tape.
And you know what? I could see people cleaning it if they wanted to make the tapes, like, perfect for whatever they were achieving, but he's someone who is running security tapes of a nothing, like, nothing happens here for years and years and years. Why would he care to clean the back? It is so weird. And you might be asking, like, why are you spending so much time with this? Like, well, because it informs our protagonist how to protect her secret. She's like,
Someone's saying it's ruled as a suicide, so it didn't warrant out all this investigation. I was like, well, you have the detective there, the famous world-class detective there to investigate, do detective work.
We find out he's been hired. He's been hired by a third party, though, hasn't he?
He's there from the beginning.
The police didn't bring him in.
Well, he's not there for the first week, isn't he? Like, that's not how... It's the police only. But that's not how it works anyway. If a body is found with everything is obvious that they've killed themselves, it's still a crime scene and you still inspect.
Especially with everyone around having a motive to do it in the family, and the will comes out, and a lot of people there, and it just happens to be that night. I'm like, interesting... Of all the nights to kill yourself, it's this one when everyone's there. Like, huh?
Yeah, I mean, how would you not suspect foul play as well? With all this is what I mean. There's loads of extra pieces of information, especially if they had checked the camera and they'd checked the times that everybody had said what had happened. They'd be like, "Oh shit, somebody pretended to leave. That's weird." No, they're all retarded, so that's what we got.
none makes sense.
So anyway, she left, I believe, at something. Wasn't it around 11 or 10, I believe, and so
midnight. She runs out and says, "Oh, it's midnight already." That's what she.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, she has to. Yeah, she has to make a big song and dance about what time it is, so that make note of that.
The camera's at 9 p.m. and she fast forwards to 10 p.m. Right, we're getting close to where we'd see her car, but then, oops, the VCR overheats.
That's legit. Like, there's smoke coming out of it.
What I didn't understand is, did she make that? Or
So again, I watched it so many times, so I didn't know what was happening in this scene. He says, you can, you know, play it, and then Benoit Blanc is like, "Can we do this any faster?" And she's like, "Yeah, how do you speed it up?" And he's like, "Press play and fast forward," which is fine. And it plays it in fast forward, which, again, we should all know how that works. I'm assuming all of us used to use VHS quite a bit. And it's playing as you would expect. And then he says, like, "You got to keep it like going, you gotta keep it down, otherwise it'll eject," and then it just does, and there's smoke all over it, which I don't understand. And then Daniel Craig says, "Is there any way we can do this, like, in an easier way, like just digitize it?" And they're like, "Yeah, okay," and she takes the tape out.
Wow, that's even worse than I remember.
It's so, like,
I'd like to point out as well, right, during this whole scene, the guy who's actually an expert in the use of this equipment is stood right next to them, but they asked Marta to operate the VCR.
Yeah, like, two police officer and Daniel Craig.
And you know that she's involved in some way. Like, oh, this person who has his blood on her shoe, you go ahead and operate the security footage. Oh, what do you know? The VCR tape broke. You
might be thinking to yourselves, like, is it just the one time? It's like, nope, she destroys evidence about a few seconds after she destroys evidence too, with the footprints. She has all these opportunities given to her because the police are retarded again.
Like, Daniel Craig, he doesn't know who else is involved at this point. He knows that she's probably involved in some way, but he doesn't know the extent of it. And she has so many opportunities to just do stuff when he's right there.
He says that he cleans the tapes with magnet. I can't remember if he says magnet or magnetism, or he magnifies it, whatever. I'm gonna have to look this up because I just don't believe it. He puts she ends up putting a fridge magnet on the VHS and it burns the whole thing, like it's all gone.
I don't believe the fridge magnet's gonna be enough if it works.
No. Yeah, I don't think that's gonna be powerful enough.
Strong at all.
Fridge magnets are shit.
Yeah, like you try to put like too many bits of paper behind them and like pin it to your fridge, yeah, that shit's gonna fall off.
Yeah. Yep. You can just
fuck fridge magnets, I hate them.
Dude, sometimes I'm touching them to see what they look like, they fall off the fridge.
Anyway, now we've established that fridge magnets are shit. Right,
cleans it as she walks out, and then the other police officer's like, hey, can I hang on to that? And she goes, yeah. So once again, you may have thought, why is she hanging on to the tape? And it's like, wouldn't the police officer want to hang on to it? And it's like, oh, he does. He just doesn't do it in time to stop it.
Like, yeah, like, here, you, person who was there the night of the murder, hold on to this for us.
So badly done. It's painful. And so next up is that when Harlan told her to return to the place after she pretended to be gone, it had rained, and so she went the back way, and her footprints are just like deeply embedded in the floor. Even a week later, they are still very clearly there. She spots that, and she's like, oh, shit. And then right as she does, all of our brain trust police officers start to notice the footprints too, and they're like, wait a minute. This is... You know, I just realized she blocks off a couple up to the entrance, but there'll be plenty of footprints left, surely.
Well, yeah, and they'd see her going up there. There'd be two sets of prints that were going upwards toward the house.
She blocked the car.
Yeah. Like the prints of the tires and shit like that. They should have seen those.
Oh, yeah, that doesn't even make sense. I was about to clarify that she destroys the evidence by reprinting her footprints, by walking in them to make it look as if, you know, they were there just now. And of course, yeah. Daniel Craig is like, no. Right. Oh, whoops.
She pretends to be like stupid and just goes back. What? Like, should I come over there? What? And just like, no. It's like, oh, what? Here? There? And then all the dogs come running and they run over it as well and basically destroy more evidence, which probably won't do much, to be fair. Just a few dog prints on it.
It's hard to watch this and just be screaming at these detectives and at this at the police, being like, why are you letting her around? Why is she here? Why are you buddies now? Why is she just your confidant, your pal, and your assistant? Like, let's see. I'm just kind of scrolling through here, looking for, just going through stuff, looking through things.
I'm just going to say as well, someone in chat mentioned that we've got a new TISM for EFAP, magnetisms.
Magnetisms.
Because of the bullshit that goes on with this.
Magnetism, yeah.
Like I said, I'm going to have to look into it. If, you know, because for all we know, we could have a VHS expert in this call who's like, yeah, magnets can do it. And I'd be like, wow. But I don't believe it yet. I'm going to have to look into it.
I went through the scene where Daniel Craig is sitting in the dark in the back porch because he wanted to talk to Marta, and she just happens to walk out past him. I'm like, huh, that's a good thing. Good thing you were there, I guess.
Oh, yeah, and it's like the middle of the night, isn't it? It's like
it's the middle of the night.
For hours just waiting for her to show up. Dark.
Yeah, outside.
And is that when he keeps talking about donuts? Like, there's a donut-shaped hole in this case, and you just can't figure it out.
I don't get that.
I don't know if I would
hate that line.
Or interesting, but it was neither for me, man.
See, you know, when you get a really cool like sleuth in cases like this, you know, they've often got these great insights. Like, they're just great lines to listen to. They can deliver a cool monologue about like the mind of a killer or whatever. But all he can do is prattle on about fucking donut holes, and that's the kind of caliber of the writing that you've got here.
Just make me hungry. That's all.
Yeah.
See, people in chat are like, a strong magnet will erase a VHS tape. Yeah,
but not a fridge magnet.
Well, that's my question. Can a
someone mentioned a degaussing wand that you might need. That's the only thing that would do the trick, but yeah, I'm not sure.
I gotta find out how magnetism is measured, and then I gotta find out what is required to erase a VHS, and then I gotta find out what the average fridge magnet magnetism is.
It says in so apparent according to the National Audio Company at nationalaudiocompany.com, it says that even a refrigerator magnet is powerful enough.
Wow.
Which is surprising to me, but yeah, there you go.
Man, do we have to just go with this one then? Are we going to let Ryan off on this
point? If it works.
then it's the matter of why did they let her hold on to the VHS tape that has the evidence for the...
Yeah, just to clarify, there are like six problems in the scene. That's one. If it erases that one, it's like, well, all right.
Well, but the thing is, if it does work, how did she erase just that specific part without destroying everything else?
The whole
because
thing.
Everything is rolled up.
It's on the wrist.
On one side.
She fucked it all, apparently, when they try and check it.
Yeah, okay.
That's weird. Because we were watching it, and it started to play like normal, but then... we got it back from you and it was all gone. That's kind of weird. Why did we let you hold on to this?
So the gist of all of this really is that, you know, Marta is following Daniel Craig around, supposedly helping him with his investigation, but trying to covertly erase the evidence of her involvement in Harlan's death and the cover up of it. And so that's like the early stages of the movie. That's kind of the dynamic there. She is trying to covertly lead him away from her trail, I suppose. But there's always the hint that he kind of knows more than he's letting on.
If Craig knows that there's blood on her shoe the first time he met her, and he knows that she can't tell a lie without throwing up, why didn't he just say, tell me the truth?
There's so many ways you could do this. You could start the conversation with, do you know who killed them? That's it. She either has to, like, not say anything or lie. Or
with all of the information she could give him from the get-go. Like, let's pretend for a second that he knows that she's involved, but he doesn't want... He thinks there's got to be more to it than that. Then get the information you can from her. It's going to make your investigation way fucking easier if you know all of... For example, how to explain the dried mud? How to explain the footprints? How to explain why the security footage... It's like she can tell you all of this.
Yeah, every time you come across something... What's this wood from this broken trellis bit for? What's up with that?
And see, right, that's interesting because you could be like, well, what's she going to do? Because, she could say, like, I'm not going to tell you, but it'll, like, super incriminate her with a detective. That's like really bad. But then later, this scenario comes up with a random guy and she tells him the entire story.
Yeah.
Instead of leaving, which she can do.
Yeah.
Also, he should have just started when, as soon as he knew, she does this and that, if she lies, did you kill Holland? That should have been his first question.
Yeah.
He never asked that question.
Or even, do you know? And if she obviously does know, so like then she's got to answer.
Hey, what happened? I don't know, man. It's weird.
So again, for people who haven't seen it, Marta has to leave the house, make a big show of leaving, then sneak back in and climb a wooden trellis on the outside of the house up to his office, which is on the top floor, and climb in through a hidden window in order to get in. And as she's going up, she breaks part of it and it falls off, and that's what she then discovers the next day, which, despite her best efforts to hide it, clues Daniel Craig in that someone climbed up that trellis, and then they find the hidden window. They find muddy footprints on the floor leading to his office. So that then...
If you remember, the thing that makes it so he doesn't want to close this case is the fact that he was hired. That's the part that makes him like, So, all that information she could have given him would answer all of the questions, and then he could just focus entirely on that particular question.
When they find the secret door up on the second or up at the top where the trellis ladder leads to, do they ever say check for prints? Like the detectives who are there with them?
He does say like to take your shoes off and stick to the sides to imply that there's like
stand on the rug
damage, but yeah, like that doesn't come up
because both of the policemen are there with him, and there's like he said, oh, there's dried mud on here. I bet it'll match the mud outside that we saw earlier, and they show that the door opens up and that it's a little secret place that people can get in and out of, and I'm thinking. It was like, she'll check for prints, because hers will be, it'll be only two sets on there, probably. And you're like, huh, that's interesting.
There's a lot of procedural stuff that's dramatically ignored in this film.
You know what would have made this so much simpler, and would have explained away a lot of these inconsistencies, is if you had had this set, like the Daniel Craig was at the party to begin with, and they were set in some isolated location where the police couldn't intervene, and he was forced to investigate this crime basically straight after it happened. Like, maybe they're on a fucking island and there's a storm happening, or whatever it might be. Then you don't have the police involvement, you don't have all the procedural stuff coming into it, you can just have a detective trying to figure out, piece together clues as he goes. That would have been so much easier than all of this. It kind of overcomplicates something that should be a lot easier.
We're near around that time as well. The broken piece of wood is picked up by a dog and provided to Marta, and it makes you wonder. It's like, wait, did nobody provide that to any of the other people across this entire week?
Yeah, I was lying around there.
I guess the dog just now found it that moment.
Yeah, the dog must have just found it, and it decided to go to her because the dogs like her.
That's very convenient.
Okay, and then of course, because our character is very intelligent, she throws it like a stick away after a dog fetched it and provided it to her.
I wonder what happens next.
Because it's a well-known fact that dogs hate playing fetch.
The film loses twice here, because it's like, on one hand, the dog never brings it back, and you'd be like, why didn't it? Of course it would. It's like fetch. On the primary hand, it does bring it back, and it fucks her over. That's exactly what you should have expected. So it's just like, it's such a weird situation. It's just like, yep, that clues them all onto the secret entrance, which you could have spotted had you given a strong eye to just the outside of the house. It's like, nobody could have gotten to Harlan without going up the stairs, and we know for a fact that it was only ever, you know, gone up or down three times in the night, which I'm not even sure really makes sense, because you're running from one of the potential suspects on that information, and someone who's very unreliable because you're sleeping. Like, how could you really know exactly what you're hearing when you're woken up? It's like, oh, it's definitely the stairs.
Yeah, and then, so the stairs were monitored 24/7 by everybody there?
Well, no, it was just, he went strictly from...
that's what I'm saying. Like, it's like, surely someone could have gone up and down and nobody noticed that whole night. That's a lot of time to fill.
Well, I think they're implying that the stairs are so creaky or so loud that, like, it's physically impossible for a person to go up without making enough noise to alert people. I think that's what he's trying to imply.
And even then, if how does he find out based off people's just sheer recollection of that night that everyone's talking about the same three creaky stair moments?
Yeah, well, it's mostly based around Jamie Lee Curtis, isn't it? Because she's the one who's sleeping below it, and she's the one who reports to the police about being woken up, isn't it? Like, I don't think the other characters have the same recollection of that.
She's entirely the one they're running from for this. Like, they treat it as though it's concrete that only three people either went up or down those stairs at any point. And that was another interesting thing, right? You have the girl who's been stealing money from Harlan. She goes up, she talks to him for a bit about the go board, and then she would have had to have gone down. I guess we count that as one, because you'd obviously hear two creaks at that point that would be separated by possibly like 5 minutes. But sure, I guess that counts as one. The second was, I forget how they account for each of them. I guess Marta coming down to say goodbye. And then the third was when Harlan came down, supposedly, to get a snack or whatever and was sent back up. That's how they account for the three. And I just find it curious, because if someone knew about the creaky staircase, then surely they would try to account for it, be it like stepping over a significant amount of the steps or trying to step lightly, trying to step on the sides of the steps. But I guess that's just not how it works. This is a definitively creaky staircase that you cannot rise or come down from without creaking significantly, to the point of waking up Jamie Lee Curtis.
Yeah. There's so much in this movie that's... It's like the script tells you this is so, and so you have to accept it. You know, it doesn't really adhere to like normal,
because
you know, logic or anything.
Do as a cop is be like, there's no other way up. Nope. And it's like, what about from the outside?
Yeah,
nope.
That ladder looking thing that leads up to a window that we could see.
No, I don't remember seeing a window up there. And it's like, good question.
Yeah.
Huh. Just seems like it just seems like walking around the house one time would have solved that problem, but I guess not.
Yeah. So we have to take it as given that the cops in this are non-people. Like, they're not thinking humans in the normal sense. They're just there to walk around and do whatever the plot needs them to do.
Well, they do at the end when Killer Man tries to stab Marta and discovers a prop knife, and they just leave him on her and don't do anything. And they're just watching them there on the floor. It's very strange.
They're also amazing at police chases, you know, during the car chase.
Yeah, so Marta was it a Hyundai Accord, an Excel. Hyundai Excel, which is shown to be a really shitty car compared to the cop's car, is apparently able to just evade their capture and stuff like that. Well, you have the issue that she is actively fleeing from police, and that's apparently just fine.
Yeah, this is just, again, I guess we should put this in some sort of context. So they realize that the blood toxicology. Like, yes, the toxicology report on Harlan is due. And is Marta gets sent a copy of it, doesn't she?
Yeah, in a way that's implying someone knows what she did and they have proof, which confused the hell out of all of us. We were like, wait, if. Because we had that problem from the beginning. The second that Harlan decided to kill himself, we were like, but the blood report will show that he was filled with morphine, and of course that'll be absolutely considered foul play. And it's only halfway through the movie or even more that they're like, wait a minute, what about his blood report? It's like, wait, what? Why would... What?
Genius!
It's amazing. And of course, it's used as a way to be like, we can prove it, which tells the audience, it's like, oh, of course that would prove it. And then we were just sitting there, like, confused, because that's the biggest problem you'd have to overcome. And so she's convinced that someone knows that she's killed him and that she's going to use it to, you know, either expose her or blackmail her or whatever. Because this is after the will reading, right? Where she's gotten all the money. All the money and resources, whatever.
There's so much to pick apart. God. It's like, we talk about one scene, and it's like, oh, but we have to go back in order to explain why this is happening. Fuck. But yeah, so they go to the toxicology lab or whatever, where the blood work's getting done. And wouldn't you know it, it's burned to the ground.
Damn.
Daniel Craig is there with the cops, the useless cops. And he happens to spot Marta in her car. Because she's yards away.
Roll back, because you missed out when they said, so all that is gone. All the blood reports just erased, and a friend of mine was like, so this is set in 2018, apparently. Even though you'd think otherwise, according to Rian Johnson, it's actually set in 2018. The smartphones would give it away, but also the talk about Trump would probably give it away that it's 2016. So blood reports and blood labs, especially when they're gone for that long, it's all like doubly stored. It's not as insecure as the point where you can throw a bottle through a window and all of it destroyed. Secondly, that goes the same for security cameras. It's a common misconception in movies that if you destroy the camera, you destroy the footage. That's not how it works.
Yeah, that's stupid.
In fact, it's definitely in their interest for the footage to be stored at a completely different location so that you can't just destroy the building.
Of course, otherwise you can't have those cool bits in movies where the camera shows them aiming the gun at the camera and they shoot. And for those, I already know this is going to come up. People are like, they do that in Civil War. It's like, yeah, but Hydra collect the files. They don't just leave them in the camera. Winter Soldier shoots the camera, but they take the files. And this is what you have to do as a writer. You've got to find out what actually happens instead of just going, I don't know, it's holding the camera, lol.
Yes.
It's not like the files that have been saved just decide, well, the camera's gone. I guess we're done, lads. We've done our job. Without the camera, we're nothing.
And then, of course, our protagonist and Ransom, who has had the... We kind of touched on this earlier, but just to remind everybody, Ransom figures out that she's got some tisms involved, and he basically has her eat sausage and beans and then tells her otherwise have to throw them up. And it's like, what?
Leave. Just leave. Leave. Just walk out.
Do whatever you want.
Call a taxi.
Help you. Believe me, you can get him in trouble.
Yeah, he's there in front of everybody else. It's a restaurant with people.
He's not going to be able to stop you. She decides, fuck it, I'll just tell him the entire plan. And then he decides he's going to help her to cover it up, and they'll split. Well, he'll take a portion of the money, is the idea. It's like, oh, okay then. So, yeah, they go to the blood toxicology place because that's obviously where it would be stored. They find out it's destroyed, so now they just need to get the copy from the blackmailer slash, you know, saboteur, whoever it is.
Because they don't have multiple copies set up anywhere. It's definitely just...
Yeah, they hand that over. That's it. Game over.
So if they get that copy, she's good because there's no proof that Harlan had morphine in the system. Even though I feel like this still would be in his corpse, assuming there is one.
Well, there would be the person who did the report. Who'd be like, wait a second, that's fucking weird.
I guess it's all automatic and no one ever put their eyes on that fucking result.
Yeah, I guess they run it through the computer and unless the computer beeps or something, they're like, oh, nothing to see here. Oh,
and someone might be wondering, wait, this is kind of a little bit later, but the person who got his toxicology report, even the film is like, wait, how the hell did she do that? The one who's like doing the secret blackmail elitism. I'm calling it blackmail for now just because it's easier to cover it that way. They have this is what I mean about throwaway lines, so fucking frustrated. So Daniel Craig says, how did she get a hold of that? And then Martha goes, oh, she has a sister who works there.
Right. And, like, yeah, like wow. You're like, oh, okay then. Well, I guess that solves that, doesn't it? Yep. She has a sister who works there.
Again, this is a brilliant like example of Rian Johnson's amazing writing, where you just have a single throwaway line to explain like a big glaring inconsistency in your plot.
I used to mop the floor of the tracker room. Okay,
we've run a decloaking scan and we've discovered several rebel transports. What the fuck?
Why do you run it constantly? I don't know.
Those decloaking scans are expensive.
Well, our electricity bill last month was, if you could see it.
I love how all of that was my attempt to explain a problem. I didn't even get to the problem. We just come across other ones along the way. So the
sorry.
And they see Benoit Blanc is there with the police officers. And the first thought you have while watching is like, oh shit, get out of there. Like, they're right. If they see you there, you're fucked. Get out of there. But no, they sit there and talk for about 5 minutes. Yeah. And then Daniel Craig sees them and he's like, hey, stop right there. And it's like, wow.
But you know, did you not notice she tries to hide? Like, she tries to duck down and it's like, he knows what your fucking car looks like. I'm like, what's the point in hiding?
And then they take off. They speed away in their Hyundai Excel. Oh,
sorry, I forgot. This is something I only noticed on my second watch through. You know how the entire plot changes when she teams up with Ransom?
Yes.
That only happens because her car doesn't start and she gets into his car. Is the implication there that he sabotaged her car or that she was just unlucky that day and her car didn't start?
Oh, right. Did you think about that?
Johnson, so it could just be that she's unlucky.
I think, you know, he seems to have a certain degree of pre-planning at that point in the story. So I could buy that he would sabotage it so that he could get her alone, so that he could then win her over.
Yeah.
Or it was opportunistic.
But it was weird because, correct me if I'm wrong, because I could very well be wrong, but the car she's trying to start up in that scene is the car that she has later when...
Yes.
So that means... So he must have unsabotaged it. Yeah, potentially.
Do you know what I mean? Wow. It's like, it's kind of like, oh, you'd think there would be connecting pieces for that.
Yeah.
You'd think that would be in and amongst Daniel Craig's final review, you know? He'd be like, and then he must have sabotaged your car in order to get a conversation with you.
Because he was standing around while that happened. He was looking at the whole scene.
He pulled up in his own car. So I guess he was... So I'd have to watch the scene again to see if there was a time where he left the room or he left them all to go outside... sabotage the car and then come back inside with everybody?
No, he did leave before everybody else when they started discussing with the guy who was presenting the will. I don't know what the word for this person is. And then he just starts laughing. He's like, oh, this is all so crazy. It just leaves.
So he goes out and instantly sabotages her car?
I guess so.
I guess you could be going with that wires out of the battery or something.
A Rian Johnson contrivance.
But if she drives around with the car later on...
He unsabotaged it once he sabotaged it and talked to her. We're going entirely from inference, because this is not something they account for in the film, as far as I know.
Yeah.
This is amazing. Yeah. We still haven't actually gotten to the thing we were going to discuss.
Right.
We've discovered like 50 other problems along the way.
That's what I mean, man. Like, it's quite a dense movie in terms of like cause and effect. There's a lot of weird shit going on constantly.
Yeah.
I think that's inevitable with the amount of characters and plot twists there are.
Yes.
Like something that came to my head, by the way, this is technically off topic, but also at the same time kind of is. You know, the way that he's cutting off Linda's husband is revealing that he's cheating on her. This is Jamie Lee Curtis's husband. He's got a letter, and the guy sees the letter in the envelope. He opens it up, and it's a blank letter, and he's like, haha, he must have been fucking with me, lol, and just drops it onto the desk. That's what he does. Mm. Later on, we see Jamie Lee Curtis is holding about 7 different letters that are all apparently from Harlan. They must have been written when, you know, he was alive, and I didn't pause it to see what they said, but she cries when she looks at them. I think they're probably very positive. But there's burn marks on them, and that's to set up that you have to put a flame underneath the paper to reveal the writing in it. And I was like, wait, she didn't ever show her husband these? He never knew that there were letters that she got from her father that were very emotional, that were only able to be seen by putting a flame underneath them? And wait, secondly,
did you get those letters in the magic egg anyways?
I'm confused as to how he couldn't have known about that. Secondly, that he would leave this letter there, even if it's blank. It's like, why even leave it? Just get rid of it anyway. You know, it leads to them breaking up because
it's odd because I'm just a person and I was like, oh, it's invisible ink. I was like, oh, it's invisible ink. He's a mystery writer.
Everyone's different, I know that, but like even if I was trying to protect this secret and I saw the letter that he brandished to me, I'd be like, I'm gonna get rid of this thing even if it is blank.
Yeah, because this symbol might have a meaning or there might be something to get a blank note from the dad with this. So were we trying to get to the cart? What were we trying to get to?
We got sidetracked a little. Yeah, so the car chase. So, yeah, Daniel Craig spots her, like, parked about 15 yards away from this building that's burned out and immediately starts, you know, running towards her to tell her to stop because he knows that she's there for a reason. She knew this place was going to burn down. She must have been involved somehow. So she immediately tries to flee from Daniel Craig and several police officers who are in like high-powered police cruisers, and she's in this shitty little Hyundai, whatever the fuck it's called. It's got a top speed of like 60 miles an hour, so that she's trying to flee down the highway, and it's like the shittest chase ever.
Well, the film is self-aware on that apparently, because one of the cops says that was the worst chase ever. It's like,
yeah,
okay.
But at one point, she does almost lose them because she does the crazy thing of jamming her brakes on and. Yeah. You know, you'd think they would have some kind of training where they might be expecting something like that, but no, they just barrel past a couple of hundred yards.
All really rough on the brain because she does that and quote unquote tricks them. Then she gets lucky and goes down 2 different pathways that 2 cars following her both get jammed on. Like one gets jammed on an alleyway and the other one gets jammed on like a piece of wood.
One like crashes into the building.
She's in the clear and it's like, oh my God, she's actually done it. And then she just parks and then they find her. And it's such a collection of people. Like this film relies really hard on everybody being stupid as fuck.
But the fact that a murder suspect and these two people were at the scene of a place that had the toxicology report that's now destroyed, the fact that they're there and they give chase to them, she doesn't get arrested or put in cuffs.
Well, the one thing you have to work with is that at this point, Daniel Craig seems to be like, you have to assume that he knows that she's directly involved, and he's kind of, this is where it gets really weird, because that was my theory and that's a lot of people's theory at this point, that he's a genius Sherlock Holmes type and that he knows what's going on. He's just stringing her along while he's figuring other things out. However, 5 minutes later she goes and visits the person who's behind all of the toxicology and blackmailing stuff, and he just listens to music in the car while she's dealing.
He just lets her go do stuff, and he knows that she's involved.
Out completely. He's like a complete fucking idiot in that scene.
Yeah, he knows that Chris Evans, and she knows that he knows that she is involved in some way, to the point where there is blood on her shoe. That's a big deal. She flees in an active police chase away from him trying to pursue her, while Chris Evans is in the car with her. And all, and then they eventually get caught. He gets taken in the police car. She does.
Did he tell you to drive? And she says yes. Implication being that he's the guilty party and that she was simply forced to drive? Question mark.
But wouldn't the police at least want to debrief her or something?
And well, yeah,
more information like, about this, because like several of their cars have been fucked up by this chase.
Already bloated. The plot has to keep moving, so he just says like, "Okay, on to our next clue." Like, let's ignore that. Let's ignore all the shit that just happened. Also, you might be thinking to yourself, if you audience member listening right now, wait a minute, you just described her lying. She just said she's not the one. She wasn't told to drive by him. She just drove herself. It's like, ah, yes, but she immediately gets into the car and vomits into a cup. And Daniel Craig misses this because he doesn't seem to care to check. He's just like, huh. And as someone pointed out on my second playthrough, vomit smells, dude.
Yeah.
That shit comes from inside your stomach.
No. It's not a nice place. She's so pure, though, that her vomit doesn't smell.
And yeah, so let's just pretend that he had said, did he force you to drive? And then she goes, no. Bleh. And then what happened then? Would he be like, okay, so he didn't force you to drive?
Well, even then, if I were involved
with this and Ransom, which, by the way, that's huge. That, like, Ransom and her are working together, and he knows that Ransom's a horrible person. What he's relying on with her is that she's good-hearted. It's like, what mm-hmm. the... This is what I mean about Daniel Craig. He's such a weird fucking character.
Well, as we all know, someone who's a detective who's made their whole living and reputation based on finding out people's lies, he could spot a really nice person. He definitely wouldn't ever be fooled by someone putting up a front to cover up a murder or a crime.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, even the fact that the both of them were at the location of the arson together is already like, so you guys met up before this and drove here specifically.
I think it's more than enough that they ran away.
Yeah, even then,
yeah, absolutely.
That compounds and adds on top of it. And even after all this, she can just do whatever she wants, really.
As an actual competent police officer, Nicholas Angel once said, innocent people don't run.
Yeah, true.
We should all be more like him.
Dude, Hot Fuzz compared to this, holy shit. That's like
that is a tight script.
Oh, I love that movie.
Is it ever existed? So.
why couldn't we have watched that instead of this? We could have talked about Hot Fuzz all night.
Oh man.
Do like once per year. It's so fucking good.
Dude, I could watch a movie every day.
Christ, so what happens next? So she to put it into some sort of context, she is being blackmailed by someone who we don't know yet who it is, but they have told her that if they want to get their hands on this toxicology report, that will be the final copy, I guess, that she can then destroy. She has to go to a specific location at a specific time, and she's almost out of time. So Daniel Craig is in the car with her. She's like, you think, like, what clever thing is she going to do to, like, distract him or buy herself some time so she can get to this meeting? And she's just like, can we pull over so I can go out for a while? And he's like, yeah. He's like,
I gotta go into this creepy abandoned building. Wait here, detective. I will be back in just a moment.
So she needs to go to this, like, there's an abandoned building. It's next to, like, a hair salon. She walks in the front of the hair salon. She goes to the back of the hair salon and out the back, which I'm surprised she was allowed to. Most places are like, what the fuck are you doing? Like, this is for staff only, but whatever.
And then she enters
the super secret meeting place by going through the back. And it's like, okay, why was your secret meeting place in the middle of town next to a hair salon? Like, this, it's like abandoned. It's just like, okay. And you might be thinking to yourself, well, because it's a public area, right? And it's like, no, actually. It's a really dark, dank, caverny type place, but it's right next and in and amongst a public area. It basically is the worst of both worlds. Because if you want to meet in a secluded area where no one could possibly, you know, see or do anything about what you're doing, that's a really bad place to be because you're about meters away from anyone. However, if you want to meet in a public area so that no one could, like, kill you, then you got to actually run out of there and scream before you can get any help.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know what the fuck she was trying to achieve by making that the meeting place, because this is a real person who really wanted to meet there, but not with our protagonist, with someone else. We'll find out. We'll reveal all that shit soon enough. So she turns up, and she sees this person, like, slumped on a chair with her shoe off, and she's like, hello? Hello? And she's like, you know what? I'll do anything. Just give me the toxicology report. You got me. And it's just like, she's not alive.
She's clearly having problems right now.
Do this stupid reveal where everything's in darkness. You can make out the silhouette of her being slouched over and clothes having fallen off, whatever. And she goes right up to her. She's like a fucking half meter away, and she still can't see anything. And so she turns her phone light on, and they do a fucking jump scare. There's a spider on her face.
Yeah, what was that?
Why is there a spider on her face?
Is this arachnophobia or something?
Oh, spooky spider. It's like, ah.
Bizarre scene, and then she wakes up, and you're like, oh my god, and she's like struggling for air. Now I'm gonna have to look into what the morphine overdose even does, because that's gonna present us. Did we cover when Harlan is apparently dying for the 10 minute mark of a morphine overdose and he's absolutely fine? Did we mention that?
We did talk about this.
Yeah, you would kind of think that symptoms would start to creep in before you actually, you know, cark it.
But he's anything, walking around, he's more lucid than ever. It's just like, okay.
Yeah, he's walking around completely normal, and you think there might have been a moment where he's like, you know, I actually feel fine.
Maybe
we should just double check this thing. Maybe I'm all right.
Hey, nurse, who can recognize liquids by their viscosity and color, why don't you check the vials and see what one you really gave me?
Yeah.
It is really odd.
She isn't aware that she can do that. It was like a subconscious thing doing that all the time. It's like, yeah.
Good nurse, she doesn't check the labels of the fucking vials.
I would also add, it is literally something as simple as he put, just to skip ahead here, new labels were put on top of the existing ones. That's all it is, isn't it? To confuse which vial is which.
Yeah, which would have gotten any other nurse. That would have fucked up any other nurse, but not this one.
Yeah. But you'd think even then she would look at it and be like, wait a minute, it seems like there's two labels here. Like, why is that? And just maybe looked at it. I don't know. Again, it just seems like something you might notice if you're looking at it kind of closely.
Well, if the police had taken the fucking bag...
They would have found that.
They would have found
that. And combine that with the toxicology, you'd be able to conclude sabotage. You'd be like, someone fucked with this nurse's medicine in order to have her kill him.
Why is everyone so stupid?
Well, this highly medicated guy who mysteriously happened to kill himself in his room at this particular place... While there was a doctor's bag full of medicine in the room opened up. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, well, I was about to say it would have meant sabotage. It's like, well, actually, it still could be the nurse. She could just be trying to make it look like she was sabotaged. There's so much to deal with, so much foul play. And then you search the surrounding area and you find all kinds of shit. And it's just like, nah, he killed himself, lol. You're like, okay.
No.
Seems cut and dried to me. So anyway, Marta gets to this rendezvous point. She finds the it's like their housekeeper or something, isn't it?
Yeah.
So
character's name,
Fran.
Fran, right?
We'll give the backstory for that because this reveals at the end, but we need it now so that we can get some context. So,
yeah,
Fran, Chris Evans is behind it all, kind of. Wait, do we explain this now or later, actually? I'm trying to think about that.
I think we have to explain it in order to explain why Fran's there and why she was actually blackmailing Marta at all. So, Evans, this is where it kind of has to all unravel.
In the party, Chris Evans found out... By the way, his name is Ransom, and everyone refers to him as Ransom in the film, except one person at one point saying his name is Hugh, and he's like, hey, don't call me Hugh, my name is Ransom, because Ransom's my middle name. And they're like, okay. So that, you need to know that, okay? Everyone listening? Good. Moving on, Ransom is upset because Harlan tells him directly that, hey, I'm going to cut off the whole fucking family and give all my fortune to Marta. And he's like, that is outrageous. It is ours by blood and rights. And this is a constant theme in the film of white people taking things that aren't necessarily theirs, even when they're bad people. Should they really get it? That sort of idea, inheritance and... immigration, lots of stuff going on there, but he's like the cartoonish embodiment of that, if you remember, because at the end he's like, this is mine, and then Daniel Craig is like, this house isn't yours, it belonged to a bunch of people that Harlan took, and he's like, shut up, person, you're ruining my rent.
Calls him Foghorn Leghorn.
So he's upset by that, and he decides that night that he's going to pretend to leave, and then he's going to come back into the house, sneak in, and switch the vials so that the nurse will accidentally kill Harlan. Unfortunately, he reads in the paper the following morning that he died of a slit throat, and he's like, wait a minute. However, all he needs is for someone to check. Isn't this his idea? Like, if someone just checks a toxicology report, it will reveal that that's why he hires Foghorn Leghorn. He'll be able to discover that, and then she'll be considered guilty, she'll be considered a slayer, and she can't get the inheritance, so it'll default back to them. I assume that's how it works. Of course, so he needs to switch back the vials, because if anyone... I can't believe that the film is having him do that because he doesn't want to get caught, and yet the police don't even fucking check. Oh, I guess she wouldn't have checked either. I don't know, even know if anyone would. He could have just... Whatever. He's going in to switch the vials back, or at least switch the labels back, or pull the labels off, and he can't because he was going to do it that night, but he couldn't because the dogs were there. The dogs weren't there the first time around, but they were there the second time around. I suppose you can explain that by having the dogs were in the house when the party was happening, and then they were asked to go outside.
Or they were kind of sex machina. They're just wherever they needed to be.
Yeah, they were where they needed to be at the times they needed to be. I'd be willing to wiggle on that a little bit, but it was still annoying me. So he can't come back to do it then. He's going to do it the following day, or the following, whenever the funeral was, right?
Yeah.
And that was days after the police had been there and checked the place. So the as far as we're concerned, the fucking vials shouldn't even be there anymore. They should be in evidence, but whatever, they were there. And he switches them. Unfortunately for him, not everyone was gone. The housekeeper was still in the place. And he managed to, like, enter without checking if anyone was there. Because, of course, if Ransom entered the house and said, hello, she would be like, oh, hey, Ransom. She wouldn't be like, I'm not here, lol. That's not how that would work. Secondly, if she heard a noise, she would be like, hello? Is anyone here? Shouldn't you be at the funeral? It's kind of weird. But no, she doesn't do that either. Neither does he. And they don't come across each other until the very moment that he's switching the vial labels. She is in the room adjacent, and she looks in and sees him doing it. And of course, she's not spotted, and she then thinks foul play has been committed, mm-hmm. and that he's done to them. So using her sister's connection, sorry, I'm getting there, I swear. Using her sister's connection in the fucking blood toxicology building, she gets a report. She finds out that she would have found out the blood would have been clear, right? Because it would be.
Yes.
Right, yeah.
Why did she say... What would that have... How could she have used that?
So...
I guess she didn't check either.
Well, the same as,
she must have made some incredible leap of logic about... I totally understood what his intentions were based on what she saw.
So she must have... Because she had the whole report, right?
I think that was... Yeah, because she only photographed the header of it to show that she had it.
Yeah.
But why wouldn't she send the whole thing?
Well, because I was about to say that it would reveal nothing, the blood toxicology report.
But yeah, it's important for the plot that we don't know the answer to that yet. It can only be revealed later.
Yeah. I'm talking about her perspective. Is she bluffing?
Yeah. So I guess she was. Maybe she was actually blackmailing,
so that she could get. So this money. Random person turns out to maybe potentially. Well, that's the thing. This is Rian Johnson writing. We can't tell if this is some crazy sub plot with some random outside character.
Rewatch the film just for that now, because I'm actually confused. What? Who, I'm sure they explain it.
Are you sure?
No. okay. Well, ignoring that, because I don't have anything else I can add to that unless I rewatch it. So, she is black. Ransom. Is sent that message. She thinks he's the one who does it. She's sent the header. And now Ransom's like, aha, if I send this on to Marta, then Marta will... I forget how this all pans out. The point is that he meets with Fran earlier than Marta does. He changes the meeting date for Marta so that she'll get there a half hour late. Wait. Okay, now I actually need to get this right because there's so many more problems if I don't. I don't know when he organized to meet her, but it was before he ended up in the car chase, obviously.
Exactly. That's what I was thinking about earlier when we started talking about this, because she gives her the morphine, right? He gives her
but he couldn't have done all of this overdose. In 10 minutes.
That's what I was going for.
This is the thing. We know that it takes 10 minutes to kill with morphine, so that means he must have done it at maximum 10 minutes ago.
But the police and
with her in the car chase 10 minutes ago.
Yeah, they put her into the squad car, I think. Let me double check. I'll scroll through here and take a look. Because if that's...
Because the timer doesn't start when they start to chase. The timer starts in that scenario whenever they meet up to drive over to the arson building, the whatever evidence place is.
Oh, fuck, yeah. We got... He's with her for ages.
For ages, yeah.
How did he manage to do this to Fran?
And she's not even dead at that point.
No.
So,
I can't explain that.
So they show up. It is... They're in their... They show up to the county courthouse toxicology building place. It's burning down. Mm-hmm. They get caught there. She runs away, get caught. She somehow ditches the police in her Hyundai Excel.
Just to clarify, right? So she finds that piece of mail from Ransom and she goes to his house. They discuss it for a decent chunk of time. Then they get in her car. They drive all the way to the toxicology place. They talk there for a few minutes. Then they get in the car chase. Then they're found by the police. Then he's taken away. Then she drives with Blanc for a while. Then she gets to the meeting place and there Fran is. How the hell does this work?
Yeah, we're looking like at least an hour of time. That passes.
Fran should be dead. There's no way.
Yeah, even if we would say she only got 50 mil instead of the 100, that's probably still enough to fuck her up in that time frame.
This is one of those films that falls apart more and more the more you think about it. You know,
like, yeah, we said that after we watched it.
Yeah, right? They take Chris Evans, they pat him down, they put him in the back of their police vehicle. Marta just says she could just do what the fuck ever she wants. It's fine, don't worry about it. You just fleed from the police. It's no big deal. That doesn't have any consequences. She manages to hold it long enough to throw up in the cup. This film gets worse the more you look at it.
Someone in chat just rightfully pointed out, we don't know how much they gave her, and it wasn't necessarily the same as thingy. Though I will highlight, can I share photos in this thing or not?
Well, I think what you'd have to do as well is...
Well, there is a shot of the empty vial.
Plus...
He would know what to give her.
You would have to stay with her long enough that she doesn't, like, run away or anything, because you dose someone up with this stuff, and as Marta explained... Right, okay.
So he knocks her out with, I assume, your standard chloroform or whatever the fuck. Then he injects her with what looks to be a full... Wait, there's a scene of that, right? We'd be able to see it.
Is it in the reveal and stuff at the end?
I think it's in the reveal, yeah.
I'm scrolling through to take a look here. So he... here, I'm at the point, just a second. And of course, it only works because Marta's such a pure, wonderful person.
Well, we'll get to that. There's another problem with Daniel Craig's assumption that she saves her because she's such a good-hearted person, and of course it would cost her hugely to save her, which... No. But, yeah.
They even have him in this... Yeah, they like in the flashback, they show him the same outfit that he was in during the car chase, so...
How did he do that?
I'm trying to think how he teleports around...
Because he'd have to do that, drive all the way back to his house before Marta arrives, and then do all of the stuff that he did. And Fran has got to survive up until that point. Yeah, sorry.
Why would he leave her shoe off?
I don't know. Doesn't he like jam the needle into her as well?
Yeah, so because he's wrestling with her, isn't he? And then...
Yeah, there was a couple of shots and then, of him doing it. You can't necessarily tell exactly how much he gave her.
Yeah.
Well, no, he says... So he sends the anonymous email to Marta saying 10 a.m., but she, I guess... So that was earlier from him. I'm trying to scroll and find out where the time was. Either way, regardless of what the time was, the morphine thing would show that it wouldn't work anyway. Because he would know what's supposed to kill her, because he knows that she, in her bag, would carry an antidote, but he left a bag there, which I guess had the antidote with it. But if he didn't want her to save her with the antidote, why did he leave it there in the bag with her to potentially use?
I can't remember if that was to like try and incriminate her or something.
But he could just have all of that stuff except for the antidote.
I have to rewatch that shit because I can't actually remember why. I'm pretty sure Daniel Craig explains why he left the bag there. I can't remember what it is, though.
Also, the blackmailer shows up and she's just like, what did she think would happen? Like, you have the blackmail evidence for someone who you believe to be a murderer, and you're just going to meet him alone here, and you're not, like, armed, and you're
because she goes, aha, I knew it was you. I knew it. And then he's like, yeah, you got me. And then he starts walking towards her, and she goes, son of a bitch, you bad. Don't kill me.
Don't do anything bad. You're supposed to let me successfully blackmail you. No.
I don't...
Yeah, if you're going to go to a meeting like that, you go with protection so that you can intimidate the person that you're dealing with.
You go to a public place, so he can't kill you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we do have a shot where you can see a kind of full syringe. It's like some measurements on it, but I don't know what they mean. There's like one...
When Marta looks at the vial, it looks empty, which apparently is the same amount that was required to kill Harlan, so... I'd say that's enough to go on.
Yeah, all that's right. Kind of enough for us to call bullshit on that one.
Well, and his whole plan is to have her be dead anyway, so he would surely give her the right dose. Like, he would know, especially because all of this was based off of a mix-up that he orchestrated, that he thought he orchestrated. Because if he swapped the labels on the vials, he'd have to swap it with something that, if given the dose of the other thing, would kill. So he would know how much it takes to kill with the morphine.
Well, especially considering the current case.
Yeah, like, that's the thing. That's how everything was supposed to go down.
Anyway, right? Like, lethal dose of morphine. I'm pretty sure Google will give you the answer to that.
It was 0.3 mil, didn't she say that in the beginning?
How much morphine will
like cause? 3 mil.
Yeah, so she gave him like 100 mil, I think.
Yeah.
Like, a complete ridiculous overdose.
100 is what's going to kill him.
It says it takes... It normally only takes 200 milligrams to induce a fatal overdose, 60 in extreme cases. Even if it's not fatal, it still requires immediate medical treatment. But that's just from the first place I looked at. So let's see. So that looks like it checks out.
So in conclusion, there's no way that's going to happen in that time frame.
All of that is garbage. Is kind of where I'm at. The whole point of this was to explain why Fran was there, right?
I think so.
That's why we just said all of that. So.
Yes.
Of course, that is why Fran is there, but that is not something Marta knows. So Marta's very confused. She's like, the fucking maid is here, and she's dying. How very fucking odd. And then, as she falls over, she starts to try and say stuff. And you're thinking to yourself, now that we know all that context, what is the best thing to say if you're Fran? Probably, hey, Ransom did this. This was Ransom. Ransom was the one. Ransom's evil. He tried to kill me. He's the one who said, Ransom. It was Ransom. What does she say instead? You did this. And she says, and this is very explicit because it fucking bothers me. It's such bad writing. She says, won't get away with this. Now, if you were trying to express that Ransom did it and he won't get away with it, which is a weird thing to say on your deathbed when you're the only person who can definitely incriminate him right now, like at least, you know, accuse, it would be weird for you to say he won't get away with this. But she doesn't even say that. She says, won't get away with this. And you know why? Because Marta can feel as though she's saying that to her.
Yeah.
Yep.
Get away with this, Marta. You won't get away with this. Really bad. And yeah, of course, we brought this up already, but in case people didn't catch it, she's saying, you did this. And one of the part of the big reveal at the end is what she's actually saying is Hugh did this. Being ransomed because it's his first name, really. And of course she would refer to him that way because that's how everyone refers to him in the film, right?
Wow.
No, it's not.
Staggeringly stupid. And that was a point in which a lot of, both on the first and second viewing, we were all fucking flabbergasted.
I'd just like to say, I have seen this exact same scenario play out in a book. It was one of those shitty Jack Reacher novels. And it's the exact same thing. A guy who's dying... Jack Reacher is standing over him, and he says the same thing. You did this, but it turns out that fuck, I can't even.
It was Henry Yu, the clock.
No, it's worse than that. Yu is the term that they use for uranium, which this guy has been exposed to, and he's in fact dying of uranium poisoning. Fucking bullshit. You could have just said, I've been irradiated, I've been poisoned, I've been exposed to uranium, but instead he goes, you did this, and that's the contrivance. And it's that level of stupidity that we're dealing with in this film.
Yep. Really frustrating.
A lot of things happen in this film in such a way that they could only happen this way in order for the plot to function, even though it makes no sense.
It is such a big brain moment, and it just makes me laugh because I know who wrote it. It's just like, you did this. His name is Hugh. Oh my god. Oh shit. Oh my
goodness, that's so great.
They're like, dude, are you kidding? Are you fucking joking right now? Why would...
So, the dumb lady who got dosed with the morphine gets taken to hospital, and we don't know her condition. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of when Marta gets hauled back to the house by Daniel Craig because they're going to get...
It's like, what the fuck? She was there, morphine, she knows the toxic, blah, blah, blah. So it's like, at this point, Marta's screwed. And she's I want to tell you the whole story. Turns out Ransom's also told the entire story to the other cops. So it's over for Marta. The story's out there. It's done. But Daniel Craig's not happy. He's like, wait a minute. Something's not quite right. And like I said, he's mainly running on the fact that he was hired. He doesn't get it. Hired him. It doesn't make sense. And that pretty much brings us to almost the... By the way, they hang on to that toxicology report in that whole scene. Nobody looks at it.
Nobody.
Nobody wants to look at it until it's the most climactic moment for someone to look at it, where she's about to renounce the inheritance, and then Daniel Craig goes, stop the wedding!
There's even a scene with Ransom where he gets the report and only flips up the top things like, oh yeah, that's a toxicology report. Words are hard. It's like, okay, I got it. And then flips it back down and just goes on. It's like, never even looked at it. Yeah. No one looked at it. It's so fucking
kind of
stupid.
It's kind of like not destroying that letter with invisible ink on it, because again, it's appropriate for the plot, but it makes no sense for the character to do that. Yeah. But yeah, so this is the kind of scene where, in a normal story like this, all of the main suspects would be gathered together in a room, and the sleuth would go through each one and explain their motivations and, I guess, why they didn't do it until they arrive at the correct person.
Yeah.
But in this one, he just kind of hauls her off into another room and starts ranting at her about what she didn't do.
While the murderer is there.
His whole plan is to coax a confession out of Ransom by luck. That is the goal of this scene.
Yeah, the thing is, all of this fails if he just doesn't say anything.
Any normal person would, because everyone knows at this point, has watched a single fucking movie, I want to see my lawyer. That's what you do.
Especially someone as apparently as clever as him, as smart as our killer is.
Once again, all the characters have to be fucking stupid to let this happen. So, yeah, Daniel Craig's, piecing it, and the reveals start to drip-feed in terms of, it totally makes sense that all of this happened the way that the audience assumes it did, but interesting piece here. And, different bits and bobs start to add up until they reveal that Hugh did this thing. there's lots of little ones, and the audience is of the assumption now that Ransom is definitely the one who essentially set all of this shit up. But of course, this is where the reveal comes in. I know we've kind of talked about it, but I just want to make sure we cover it. The vials were switched by Ransom. The nurse grabbed both vials, and she just by instinct picked up the one that has the correct weight and viscosity that she is used to, rather than looking at the labels. Now, I'm going to go ahead and guess that any nurse worth their salt does not fucking do that.
Anybody doesn't just randomly inject chemical substances into people, especially knowing that one of them is essentially poison.
Yeah,
it is.
When there's a difference of 97 mil between the two doses.
Yeah,
normally
you want to double check.
what you would have there is an example of like, okay, so your laziness actually won out. That's crazy. But no, they frame this as a positive. This only happened because she's so fucking good.
You know, so good that you just fucking basically were guessing.
You accidentally saved a person's life. You're like, wow.
Well, only for him to kill himself anyway.
Yeah, a bit awkward. I'd be curious to look into what nurses have to say on this subject.
If there's any in chat,
I will be asking.
Someone just wrote, "I would lose my license if I did it that way."
Well, as long as nobody found out, you'd be fine. You just have to hope you write every fucking time.
Yeah, that's the thing. You mess up once, somebody dies.
Yeah.
But what's even better, this truly was the greatest moment of the film. She takes a phone call from the hospital, which she then announces is that...
So, context-wise, right, they establish all of this shit happened with Fran, and Fran is going to be somebody who can implicate Ransom. So, yes. if Fran's alive in the hospital, then he's fucked, and that's when the phone rings. Which fucking hell, the timing on that.
Yeah.
And they call Marta?
Yep, they call Marta. Yeah,
she gave her number.
Yeah, but fuck that. What about her family members? What about the people in the house?
Nope. They're not good persons, though.
Nope, they call Marta.
Yeah, call Marta so either way, Marta announces that Fran is going to be okay and that she can implicate Chris Evans or Ransom. At which point he realizes the game is up and he just launches into a tirade of like, yes, I fucking did it. I admit everything. I'm the murderer. I did all of it. But you can't pin me for murder because ultimately I didn't kill. Yeah, I didn't kill Harlan. Yeah, and I didn't kill Marta because, you know, she's not dead, clearly. So all you would have me for is attempted.
He says arson or whatever. And he says, I'll go down for arson, I'll go down for attempted murder, but I'll get out eventually because I have really good lawyers, and then I'm going to ruin your life. That's what he says to her.
In front of two policemen. Cops,
yeah.
It's like, wow, okay.
Oh, so you were really, really smart up until the end where you need to be an idiot. I got it.
But it's okay because Marta's got this covered.
Language he uses is fucking garbage. He says, I killed her. Or I guess I didn't because of the information. So they had him say the words, yes, I killed her, in the most contrived way possible because you're going to need those words in a moment. But go ahead.
It's okay because Marta has in fact been recording this conversation on her phone and she's been lying to him.
It was the cop.
He's been coming. But she has, in fact, been lying to him because Fran did, in fact, die in the hospital, so he is going to be charged with murder, and then she promptly barfs in his face because she's been lying.
Yeah, but after the time passes, so she could stomach this lie, but the other ones, no.
Yeah, we never see her being able to stomach a lie for about a couple of seconds, but this one, she goes on for a nice long while.
Yeah.
Just until she gets what she needs.
Really, it's not about her being... I don't even, whatever. It's such garbage. So,
Of
course, that means that they now have the confession of him killing her, and she's dead, which means he's going down for murder, which means his life is pretty much over. So what does Ransom do?
So there's a giant, best I can describe it, is like a display of knives on the wall beside him. So he yanks one off of this display and lunges at her, and it all goes into slow motion, and the cops kind of just stand there watching him do it.
The cops are immediately... The first assumption that I think Rags and I had was that Daniel Craig was going to die for it.
Yeah.
Like he was going to jump in front of the knife or something, but... They show all of the cops slowly moving toward it, and the point of that was to show that they're not going to make it in time.
Yes, because they totally aren't guarding him or anything.
Something that the second watch through someone pointed out is once they establish he's a murderer, they let him walk right up to Marta and like intimidate the fuck out of her, and it's like arrest him, arrest him.
But
Daniel Craig would have told the two cops beforehand, like, by the way, I seriously think that this guy is the murderer. Y'all need to like be right there, ready. Yeah.
Yeah. Have your guns ready. You know.
And one of them is like a big fan of his, so they would obviously believe him.
He was a big fan of Harlan's work. I don't remember if he was a fan of Daniel Craig or not.
Well, I think he would. Surely he'd.
I think he was, because there was this one scene where
it wouldn't matter anyway.
The one cop wants to step in, is like, "Hey, what are you doing?" And the other guy says, "No, no, let him do the thing."
Yeah. So
if a fucking detective tells you this guy is probably the killer, when we reveal this, he might get a little bit, you know, killery.
So either way, he grabs this knife off the display. The fucking Keystone Cops are nowhere to be found, and he lunges at Marta, tackles her to the ground, and plunges this knife right into her chest. And so you think, "Oh shit, she's dead, son." But it turns out that it's a joke knife, lol. It's just one of those ones with the retractable blade like you would get from a movie set, I guess.
It's really clever. They set this up at the beginning.
They set this up with a really rough, totally out of place bit of dialogue where Harlan's talking about Ransom, saying, "Oh, he's always been a wayward boy. He wouldn't know the difference between a prop knife and a real one," which I don't know why you would ever say that about someone. Wonder if this will be relevant later in the movie. But anyway, it is relevant. And I'd like to point out as well that that display seems to contain an awful lot of real knives. Yeah. So is it just sheer bad luck that he picked the one fucking prop one out of all of them? All props? I don't know, because they didn't all look like they could have retractable blades.
No. Yeah, there's some clearly ones that are real looking at it.
There's even axes on there.
They have the capability to retract if you look at them.
Yeah.
But the great thing about it as well is, like, because she, you know, he's plunged this into her chest and she's like, "No, I'm not dead." And then he brings the knife out really slowly so that the blade extends again. And then he pushes it back in a couple of times just to make it really obvious.
Where the fuck were the props at that point? They don't pull him off for a good, like, 15 seconds. They just walk
him. Weird. They're just letting him be down there on top of her on the ground with what they assume to be a knife in her chest. He's just like, I mean, she's up now, so I guess it doesn't really matter.
Fuck, man, this movie.
You guys love insisting things are contrivances. Well, with contrivances, but we don't tend to do it for other stuff.
Yeah.
That's at least
like,
my
thing. Oh, I just happen to have a relative who works at the place that she can do this thing for the plot. All of a sudden, this has not been set up.
Like, the idea that Harlan, of all the ways he could have explained that his son is a little bit, you know, as Drinker put it, wayward, he's like, couldn't tell the difference between a real knife and a prop knife. If I was in the room, I'd be like, what has that got to do with anything?
You may as well have said, like, wouldn't know a fake toxicology report from a real one.
He would probably try and kill somebody by switching their medication. You know?
Okay. Like the kind of person to do that, you know? Yeah.
So that, I guess that kind of brings us to the end of it. Like, he gets hauled away by the police eventually, and Marta inherits the entire fortune, and the family are left outside.
Yeah, they're all outside looking up upon her glory.
She stood on the balcony, and she's even got a coffee cup that says "My house, my rules,"
which is one of the opening lovely. The opening shot of the movie is the house shot, and then they show the cup. So. That's also clever editing, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, genius work on Ryan's part.
There's more, but I think that's probably coverage-wise, that's probably pretty strong.
I mean, like, overall thoughts on the film? Like, fuck, I don't even know what to say about it.
I don't think it was good. I think it was really cheap writing. I don't think there was a lot of talent in terms of writing behind it. I've seen a whole lot better from Poirot episodes and Monk episodes. I really am not at all impressed. Wouldn't watch it again. Wasn't really entertained by it. It was just curious to see if it was good or not, and so that's why I watched it. I wouldn't rewatch it unless it was for research purposes, I guess. But
I thought it was dreadful.
Yeah, you thought it was pretty bad. Really, it was extremely unimpressed at the end. Very disappointed.
From a mechanics point of view, in terms of the plot, yeah, it was garbage. Like, I almost got the impression it was just a bit of a lark for everyone involved. Like, they all kind of seemed to be having a bit of fun with it, and, you know, Chris Evans was obviously enjoying the chance to play a total asshole bad guy, and Daniel Craig's hamming it up with his accent, and everyone else is playing, like, kind of ridiculous over-the-top caricatures of real people. It just all felt like a bit of a laugh they were having, and nobody was taking it too seriously. And yeah, I don't know if that's how you really want to approach a film like this, to be honest, because I think the point of these whodunits is they're supposed to be engaging, and you're supposed to get people engaged by making them believe it's real people that are involved in this, like likable people that you can get invested in. But none of these people were likable.
Yeah, I guess we should probably, you know, honorable mention, like, acting was absolutely fine, if not good.
Yeah, it was good. Acting was very good.
Cinematography, there's once again a whole bunch of shots that I'm like, oh, that's a nice shot. That camera movement that I'm like, hey, I like the way this is directed. I remember the way sometimes how the camera tightens. On my second watch through, one of the people watching with me got really annoyed that the same sort of camera tightening was used several times over, but I'm mostly okay with it. The camera being alive is something I quite like. Just something that it's moving around with the scene instead of, a static shot. But I'm still okay with them as well. But music, I don't remember remembering at all. I don't remember remembering
at all. Oh, so, yeah, I don't remember it.
There was a soundtrack, but it was pretty anemic from what I remember.
I can't even... You could have told me there was no music, and I'd be like, yeah, okay.
I mean, I kind of... When we started watching it, I said, like... You know, ultimately, it's in terms of cinematography, it's just going to be a bunch of people in rooms. Like, there's not a lot of ways you can fuck that up. Like, it's never going to look bad, particularly. But yeah, it was fine from that point of view.
It's entirely like before I'd seen this, I was like, I think Knives Out is supposed to be like proving that Rian Johnson isn't as bad as one thinks. But I was like, no, this slots right in with what I expected. Like 100%, because a lot of people think that Lupa's amazing. Lupa suffers from basically all the same problems we've just highlighted, by the way.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's a hot take or not. Watch YMS's video on Lupa. He goes through all of the fucking problems with time travel and what everybody's doing in that film. He does it pretty quickly, too.
It's like this thing with Rian where he messes with genres and concepts that require a real air of discipline as a writer. Like, you have to be able to explain a lot of different things, and you have to explain it really well to make it function. But he doesn't have the skill or the ability to do it, so his tactic is to just either have throwaway lines or just, you know, skirt around the issue and not even address it. Like in Looper, you know, when Bruce Willis is essentially having a conversation with himself, like a younger version, it's like, well, how come you don't know this entire conversation then? And he's like, well, I can remember it as it happens, but not like how it all played out beforehand. But just don't think about it too much, because you'll drive yourself crazy. Like, well, the audience can get
driven crazy. And
in terms of stories, right? No matter what your plan is, be it like, I'm going to take the slasher genre and apply it to halfway through an action movie, which is kind of what Predator is, or I'm gonna combine zombie with some other well-known genre, and it's just going to smash in at one point. Or this movie, which is clearly like your standard sort of affair with whodunit, but then they flip it on its head when we get the full story halfway, well, half an hour in. Like, that's unusual. And it's, of course, tied in with a lot of elements that he's playing with. But I'd be like, every one of these things still sits on continuity. You can't escape it. You have to actually nail that. I don't care what you're trying to achieve with, like, I'm going to make a dinosaur movie in space. I'm like, okay, well, cool, but... you actually do it. And this is something I was talking with Fringy about, right? But like, what's often said about people who quote-unquote nitpick, go for the details, all this stuff, we miss the forest for the trees, that's what they say. We look into all the how it was made, all the pieces that make it up, instead of appreciating the overall whole, which is, it's a really cool whodunit with lots of interesting performances and a nice little twisty tale and an interesting new look on this thing. It's nice to look at, nice to enjoy. Can't you just chill out? The response is obviously you're missing the trees for the forest. You're looking at the overall project and ignoring everything that is involved that makes it. All of these component parts are really important, and it's the only way that we can improve, instead of just going, you know what? I like that forest, even though it's a dead forest with fucking moldy trees that's been spray painted green. It sits next to this incredible, luscious forest that's all built from the ground up and looks incredible. And we're trying to point out the difference between those two, and they're sitting there like, they're both forests. Who cares? Yeah. Rian doesn't get the participation award, and that counts as fucking Oscar worthy. He won an Oscar for the screenplay, right?
What?
Surely not.
No.
Oscar. Best original screenplay nominee. It didn't win.
Oh,
Well, that's
fuck. Got nominated.
You know, like, I think I said this when we did our watch through, right? I kept expecting that once we got to the end where Chris Evans is getting taken away in the police car and stuff, that there's some final revelation that kind of recontextualizes all of it. Like, there was another layer of deception on top of all of this, which would have made sense. Yeah, and I kept waiting for that, and I was like, oh, there's going to be something really smart to top this off, and it's going to like make sense of all of these stupid contrivances, and that will really tie it together. But it never came, because there wasn't one, because this is just, it's fundamentally, it's just a bog standard whodunit. Like, there's nothing really imaginative about it.
Mike mentioned, like, I'm not huge into whodunit stuff, but like, I actually saw Murder on the Orient Express, the new version. I know a decent chunk about murder mystery stuff. I've seen plenty of them. Someone just recommended Gosford Park. I've actually seen that, and it's way fucking better. And it actually has like a really important point to make about that movie's about class rather than is this movie about immigration? I'm not 100% clear. I'm
assuming you're pretty clear. I think undertones with how a lot of stuff was framed and with how characters behave and.
Did you notice at one point when Richard's having his rant about immigration and stuff, about how they need to come in the legal way and it doesn't matter if they're good people, like if they're illegal then they need to be deported, like, and he's standing there gesticulating and holding his plate that he's been eating from, and just as he's speaking and doing that, Marta kind of just gently comes in and takes the plate out of his hand like she's a kind of servant, and he doesn't acknowledge her or anything. Again, yeah, it's making that point that she's just like constantly like clearing up his stupidity or his, well, you know,
that's not even his job, right? I think the quote unquote the gag there is that he's like, you did it right, you're here good, you're one of the good ones, as she is essentially like in slave labor or some shit. Like,
yeah,
going forward with that.
Yeah,
because fucking hell, those talking points, man. They're all in cages. Well, they came here illegally. Shut up, anchor baby, SJW snowflake. Oh, yeah, alt-right Nazi. You sit there like, wow, this is...
Yeah. Ryan, yeah, that's Ryan taking all of his Twitter experience and putting it into action.
It's a special kind of cringe when you go to escape and then you're like, oh, wow, real world, hello. But only a certain sect of the real world. Certainly not how these people would be talking to each other.
Yeah,
and every time it happened, it didn't really add anything to the story. They could have talked about anything during that time frame.
But I've been told that some people consider it quite a nuanced representation of political discussion, and that
fuck off.
Oh, nuanced. Jesus Christ, it was so on the nose. I felt like I got punched.
Nuance, man. Yeah,
that's nice out. I want to clarify that I did notice a lot of people saying that this movie was not only easy to enjoy, but it was pretty damn good. I don't know if we've changed any minds, but I honestly think the complete fucking reverse. I thought it was garbage.
You need to really go back and look at the plot and see what actually happens and see what is required to make the plot happen.
I think if you just look at this on the surface level and it's like, oh, okay, it's like, you know, you got a bunch of quirky characters and it's kind of snappy and, you know, it moves along at a fair clip with stuff happening, and there's a few revelations and all that sort of thing. You know, you can put your brain into neutral and just sort of enjoy it. But like we've demonstrated here, if you start to pick at the threads a little bit, the whole thing just unravels because there's so many things that just do not work and do not make sense. And the more you think about it, the more it falls apart.
We did it.
We did it, everyone. Hooray.
we ruined Knives Out. Yay.
Hold on. Woo-hoo.
No, that wasn't us. That was his own fault.
Oh, Ryan killed it.
Yeah, right. Ryan.
There wasn't anything to ruin.
You've killed another genre, Ryan. Stop killing things. Can't
keep getting away with it.
sci-fi fantasy and whodunit. Who's next? Also, I think we talked about this when we were watching it, but whodunit is the last fucking genre he should be touching. Like, the kind of fucking that he does.
I don't understand what genre he would really be suited to. Like, there's anything that doesn't require a plot, I suppose.
Well, unfortunately, stories kind of need to follow along. Cause and effect is a huge thing in stories, and he hates cause and effect, so
Yeah, I don't think he should be a writer at all. Like, he's a perfectly adequate director. I mean, it's fine. Just
I wonder how he
don't ask him
work.
To write.
I guess people will just accept anything to a degree. They're just like, oh, well, it's a murder mystery. I really, really liked it. It's like, but it didn't make sense. But that's okay, because I just like it, because whatever, it's fine.
Well, he put all the talking points in the film, didn't he? So I'm sure that won him an awful lot of fans in Hollywood.
That could work, because he actually has to portray as it happened. He can't just fucking run around, you know?
Oh, I was thinking documentary, yeah.
That could work. There you go, Rian.
Writing.
We found a niche for you, Rian. Off you go. I do have quite a few super chats here. Would you gentlemen be amenable to going through some of them? See if we can tackle them.
Yeah, sure. Yeah,
I'm here.
All right, nice one. Let's see. Charles Caballero says, "Glad you're doing this, gentlemen. Legendary show." He also says, "One thing I miss in movies and TV, less edited fight scenes. Just trust their actors are efficient. The exception is Cobra Kai. Generally solid fights."
Yeah,
as long as the camera works good. Yeah, absolutely.
It's always contextual for me. Like, I think all the fights in Hot Fuzz and chases are all very highly edited. Obviously, the benefit is it helps you feel as though it's very quick and action-packed and high energy. But then being able, like, I do love me some long wide shots with fights. When you get so immersed into fights, it just seems real. So
yeah,
I think it entirely depends. It depends on how good your actors are as well. Like, some actors just cannot fight for the life of them.
By fighting, I immediately go to the Raid movies or the Raid movie, the first one. Those are like really good fights, and they're really long, and you can just see what's happening. There's like no shaky camera and stuff like that. It's just like solid fighting action, and I really, really like it. Old Boy has like the really stylized one with the long corridor from the side, which looks really cool.
Yeah, that was all done in one take as well, wasn't it? Like, I remember that one because it's one shot, so it just kind of continually tracks him as he goes along the corridor, and it lasts a good couple of minutes. So that's some serious choreography they did for that one. But that's, you know, you kind of have to go to these like martial arts movies and stuff where all of your cast are trained fighters, whereas you know, you look at Western movies, you know, look at something like the fight scene in TLJ in the throne room. Like, they are continually missing their marks, and the poor stuntmen have to try and compensate for that, like, all throughout the fight, because they're not good fighters.
And they thought that the one from the Rise of Skywalker was so good they showed it twice.
Oof. But there's a lot of good fighting movies out there. Ip Man, the first two are pretty good, if I remember correctly. Ong Bak was one. I think the first one was really, really solid. I don't know about the other ones. I think they weren't that good. I haven't watched them in a while. But yeah, they're really, really fun to watch, at least for the fighting scenes alone.
Charles Caballero also says here, "On that note, how legendary is it that we generally get to see all these Cobra Kai actors work their arse off to be capable of fighting? From Johnny and Danny to Miguel, Hawk, and even Stingray, legends." I don't know if any of you guys watch Cobra Kai. I think the actors, do most of their own fighting and most of their own stunt work and stuff. And generally, they're not too bad.
I have no idea what it even is, so no.
Okay. Fair enough. Yeah, well, you know the Karate Kid movie from like the 1980s?
Uh-huh.
Have you ever heard of that? So, yeah, this is like
Have you heard of Karate Kid?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, so this is like a sequel to that, like a TV show based around 30 years later. So they're still kind of rivals to each other, but it's reversed now so that the bad guy from Karate Kid is now the kind of hero of this, like the underdog.
And
it's quite funny. It's kind of a comedy drama thing, but it's not bad.
He's probably upset that he lost his final fight with a move that was clearly explained to be illegal, and no one gave
They referenced that quite a bit.
Oh, dude, really?
Yeah, well, he's like, because Daniel, who was the hero of Karate Kid, is now like the one that's got the upper hand. Like, he's rich and successful. I think he's a car salesman or something. And Johnny crashes his car, and he has to, like, it gets towed or something, so he has to recover it from Daniel's dealership. And, you know, Daniel's kind of like playing around with them, like talking to his friends, like, oh yeah, me and Johnny used to fight back in the day, and you know, I kicked his ass at the karate tournament. And Johnny's like, oh yeah, that's funny, because like you did an illegal move. You know, it's just like little lines like that.
I just want to bring up something that I just found out interesting detail about Knives Out. Many of the characters in the film are seen to constantly be on their phones, all of which are iPhones. One character we don't see using a phone is Ransom, who later turns out to be the real killer. Oddly enough, this was a requirement, as Apple does not allow villains in movies to use their products.
Really?
Oh, wow.
No idea.
So...
wow.
That's ironic, since villains basically make their products.
Rian Johnson commented on this, saying that you should be careful letting people know, because it can spoil movies in the future. Couldn't you just give them a fucking phone that has... any phone, just give them a...
Yeah, I was going to say, there's other brands. Their phones, unless they absolutely need to be at a phone.
Like, assuming that's true, just give them a fucking, you know, a phone that doesn't have any company on it. I don't know. What a weird...
stupid...
What a fucking stupid random rule. Brick, you know?
Yeah.
That's amazing. Dan Campbell here was saying, I'll check out the review later, but only if Critical Drinker promises to stay away from those knives, at least while he's imbibed, which is always... It is, although I'm a bit soberer tonight because there was so much to try and keep my head around with this fucking film. I was like, yeah, I've got to try and stay somewhat sober, otherwise I'll never be able to remember what goes on.
And you'll coincidentally and conveniently grab the prop knife anyway.
I will, yeah.
Is there any reason we can't assume they're all prop knives?
Yeah, because some of them can't be
a prop knife doesn't have to be retractable.
I guess it could be totally dull, or made of some kind of a bendy material that's just shiny, I guess.
It would just be strange to have an entire display piece of like hundreds of prop knives there. Like, where would you get them all from? I don't know.
And the fact that Harlan said he can't tell the difference between a prop knife and a real knife, I guess the only real knife in the house was Harlan's in his room. I don't know.
Hmm.
Yeah. Which coincidentally was sharp enough to slit his own throat. That did bother me, actually. Can you really slit your own throat and kill yourself? Like, it seems like that would require quite a bit of cutting. And you wouldn't necessarily be able to do it.
I think you'd go for the wrists as well, or the, you know, running lines down your forearms as well.
Like, yeah.
And he's so... it's just something he's so like... Quick. What's happening now? I'm just talking about the psychology of, like, you're going to slit your own throat? Damn.
Like, fucking hell, you don't want to shoot yourself?
Aren't you scared?
Oh, we didn't mention, by the way, that blood manages to splatter from that part of the room all the way onto his shoe. Like, it's a bit much. It flings quite far.
Yeah, that was convenient. And just one tiny spot, like, not a huge splash that would be obvious to her. Just that one little piece. What's the next one? Jonathan Beats says, Drinker, I need you to fix a movie for me. Not really a character. Try and fix Suicide Squad. Wow.
Well, get in line. James Gunn's trying to fix it.
Yeah, that would take some doing. I'd probably delete the whole thing and start again. Where's my fridge magnet? Yeah, that is a movie with a hell of a lot of problems. I love how each character kind of gets introduced twice. That always stuck with me.
What, Suicide Squad?
Yeah.
Only got three introductions?
Maybe. It was pretty consistent with two for everyone, apart from, like, the girl with the katana that sucks your souls out for some reason.
Kind of rate introductions, because you get the, you know the one where all their stats come up on screen when they show them? You get that one. You get the one where we first go to the prison, where it shows all of them individually, and then you get the one where she's, like, explaining all of them at the dinner table. I remember a lot of people noticed this. It was really fucking weird.
I thought that was the one where you get their stats as well, where she kind of names each one, and then it freeze frames on their, you know, on them.
I can't remember if people were categorizing them as like almost double dipping intros, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
But yeah, there was definitely a lot of, and this was the funny thing, is that they put so much effort into giving so many intros to these people, and then they forget Katana. Like,
what? She just shows up on the chopper. Oh yeah, this is Katana. She's got a sword that can suck your soul out somehow. Don't question it. What the fuck? Yeah, I love it, because if this had been an MCU movie, there'd be some complex like explanation for how this happens, but nah, it's just, it's got your soul in it. If she kills you, great.
She's got yeah. All right.
Laurie Roberts says, this movie felt like the studio had contracts with all of the actors and nothing to do with them, so in honor to to honor the contract, they put them all in one movie and gave it to a hack and rolled the dice.
Oh, yeah. No, this film's getting a sequel. It's been announced.
Wait, what?
Oh, what?
Yeah, they're making a sequel, which to me raises a fucking eyebrow hardcore. Like, a sequel?
What are you doing?
I guess the family's going to try and get revenge on Marta because they're all terrible, horrible people.
So thinking that it could be an anthology thing, like maybe Knives Out 2 takes place in a different place with a different family, you know? Like Hill House. I don't know.
Why does Rian Johnson keep getting work?
No.
Because people for some reason really suck that shit up, I guess. I don't know.
I mean, I guess this movie, like apart from the actors' salaries, like this would have been a fairly cheap movie to make.
Yeah.
So I assume it made money, but not like enough to really justify a sequel or some kind of weird franchise from it. It's just, yeah, it's bonkers. Laurie Roberts says, after watching this whodunnit for about an hour, I didn't care whodunnit. I never saw the end. I still don't know whodunnit. Well, hopefully we've illuminated you a little bit. There's Chris Evans!
Which was a strange choice, because he's the one that we don't get any information on for ages, and he's treated as the bad guy and the black sheep for ages, and we're like, so is it him? And the film's like, yes. And you're like, oh.
Like, all right, cool. Cheers.
Yeah, thanks for that. Andrew Fritz says, is this supposed to be Alpha EFAP? Yeah, we got some of the EFAPers on. Alpha. It's because we... Sorry, what?
Alpha, or the Alpha EFAP.
Franco, are you there for that meme, or are you not? Because I think that was Az and Alex, and I can't remember if you were there or not, but basically, Ralph the Movie Maker is upset that the butler and Joker may or may not have been Alfred.
That's supposed to be Alfred?
Isn't this supposed to be Alfred?
Yeah. It's not really something I would get upset about, but yeah. Okay. Well,
yeah, there's you, being a nerd, getting upset by the mechanics in a whodunit when you should be comparing or complaining about the guy's name. Fuck.
Yeah.
So actually, while we were streaming this stream, someone in my Discord posted a Ralph the Movie Maker video, this pop quiz hotshot into Boldly Flee, and they said, "Has Ralph always been this vitriolic, or is this a new thing since Joker?"
Was he nice and calm in that one? Or?
No, I guess he's being really. Oh, vitriolic in this one video that got posted of him. So I don't know. He does come across as a very angry boy, but he's not smart enough to justify his anger in some entertaining way. You know,
did he go down the movie Bob road of like hating Joker?
Well, yeah, he's really
getting, yes.
Yeah.
He came up with some very interesting reasons to hate the film.
Right.
You remember when Joker slams his head against the glass and it smashes? He's upset. Yeah. CGI and it is really bad. You can clearly tell it's CGI, which
everybody used to know.
Yeah, I don't know that it was CGI.
No clue. I had no idea.
That was a weird one.
Is this like the cinema sins one of just like making shit up to be angry about?
Funny thing, I looked at as cinema sins types, and I'm like, oh no. No, those are really bad. We don't. Hopefully.
Yeah, we don't just throw in a random word and count it as a sin against the movie and then just move on with no context.
Yeah. No lap dance in the scene, ding.
Ding.
Yeah. Discount Celebrity X. Bing. What the fuck? Anyway, Mark in 3D says, Just Right told me he can watch this movie 100 times. He can't be wrong. Anyway, buy rags.
Oh, bye.
Is Just Right a fan of...
Very much so. He loved Knives Out.
Right.
I mean, I can watch this movie 100 times. I could also shit in my face.
Just Right is just Wonderful. I had a feeling that it would end up that Dives out with shit. I knew he liked it, so I was like, oh, this is going to be great if it's fucking nonsense, because it's just, yeah, it lines up. And I watched his video on Knives Out. He praises it for playing with the genre, basically.
But it doesn't. It just does. It's a really bog standard whodunnit.
No, it does. It totally does. And that's, even if it did, I don't see how that's enough to praise it. It's always about execution. Just, if my idea was to blend romance and comedy, which is very fucking common, and you're like, yeah, okay. And then I go, wait, what about romance, comedy, and horror? You're like, okay. I'm still looking to see what it is. I don't really care that that's your idea. What about dolphin killers? I don't know.
Musical Duder says, did any of you guys feel even slightly surprised when the twist was revealed?
No. Mm-mm. Not at all. In fact, I thought there would be like a secondary twist at the end to show that he wasn't really the one.
Yeah.
Because I was not at all surprised.
Yeah.
When you're in the hospital and after the Fran thing had happened, it's like, yeah, so I'm going to need a lot more information, movie, because I don't know what the fuck you're trying to achieve right now. Like, this is weird. But I mean, we all knew Ransom was going to be the dude. Because he gets so involved randomly, and there's clearly tism's going on there. And then, you know, they quote-unquote peaceful thing. I was shocked by the Hugh did this thing. I did not see that coming. I didn't think anyone would be that stupid. Like, that's,
yeah.
That's staggering shit.
Very
stunning. Yeah, I think that was the hallmark of where we were surprised with this film, is like, wow, you're really doing this, aren't you? Like, this isn't a joke. Just, yeah, relying on these kind of contrivances, that's just bad writing. Emily Levine says, what did you guys think of Brick? I recall liking it when it came out in 2005, but I haven't seen it since.
Only by the way, good things. Only heard good things.
Never heard of it.
Never seen it, I'm afraid.
Press X to doubt now, because I've been told over and over again that Knives Out was great, so...
Yeah. The only Rian Johnson movies I've seen has been TLJ, this, and Looper. And I'm not impressed by any of them.
Yeah, I was also told Lupo was fantastic, and when I watched it, I was really disappointed.
He is really good at just fooling people. Oh, that's just all I can include.
Yeah, like, what is this shit? Every time. There's a literal line in Lupo that's like, stop thinking. It's like, okay.
I'm trying, but it doesn't work.
It's when the movie...
That's not an option. Like... There's not a switch I can just flick.
Well, you remember, like, Drinker, have you seen Prestige?
Yes.
That film is basically like, it opens with saying, are you watching closely? That's the line it gives, which is the standard, you know, magician line.
Yeah.
Because the whole fucking point is, if you pay perfect attention and you remember all the details, you will be able to catch exactly what's happening in this film right before they reveal it.
And you ain't gonna.
Yeah, when you get the sort of montage of all the things throughout the story that explain, like, seemingly odd behavior and stuff, it's like, oh, right, okay, that's fucking clever. Like, well done.
Because Rian Johnson, like, gets as much work, if not more, at this point than certain writers who are trying that hard, and they don't get shit all, you know?
Yep. It's a strange one. The Justice 35 says, pints out, Drinker. Hate to say it, but Rian Johnson is the Stallone Judge Dredd who desperately wants to be the urban Judge Dredd, Spielberg. he's a strange one because Spielberg tells stories in a conventional way, whereas Rian Johnson seems to think he's so intelligent and he's got such a genius intellect that he can craft these amazing stories that are the opposite of what you would expect, and you're just going to be blown away by how smart he is. But his stories always end up the opposite of that. You're just blown away by how dumb they are and how contrived they are and how they contradict themselves. His ambitions always exceed his actual abilities. I mean, he did that episode of
Breaking Bad, wasn't it?
Yeah, Breaking Bad, The Fly one.
Oh.
But he didn't write that, did he? He just directed it.
Well, that's the thing. He did The Fly and he did Ozymandias, which most people consider those the best and worst episode of Breaking Bad, which is so fucking interesting to think about, isn't it? And of course, he didn't write either of them. So as far as I'm concerned, his directing in both is... I think The Fly's direction was fine from what I remember, but the directing in Ozymandias was actually pretty good. Like, I remember liking it a lot. So, Ryan, keep directing stuff. I'm cool with that. You go, you go, Gil.
Just stop convincing yourself. Writing things.
Love the idea to be like, well, wait, don't you think I can get better? And I'm like, no, you think you're doing great. So you're never going to be able to improve because you think this is the right direction.
I don't even, like, if I was to give his writing some advice, I'd be like, just dial back the ambition, dial back the complexity that you're trying to work in because you're not capable of it. Tell a more straight up story, but try and create really interesting characters or give them really cool dialogue or something. But you can't
consistency in your plot.
Yeah, you're not capable of doing complex stories with cause and effect and consistent, you know, rules. There's a follow-up super chat here. Have another pint on me, and I know you're busy, but I would love to see your take on the two Dread movies. Maybe a new series called The Drinker Compares. Interesting.
Oh my goodness. The Drinker Compares.
With do Jurassic Park and Jurassic World.
I never saw the original Judge Dredd. I saw the redo with Carl Urban, and I really liked it.
Yeah. Yeah, it was really good. I don't know why it flopped so bad. I don't know if the marketing was shit or...
I want to make that clear. We're in a world where Knives Out does amazing and gets a sequel, and Dread, nobody fucking saw it. what happened?
You're correct. I haven't seen it.
It's really good. I mean, it goes back to exactly what I was saying there. It doesn't tell a particularly complex story. It's like Dread and his fellow judge are kind of trapped in a tower with a bunch of people that want to kill them, and they've got to fight their way out, and that's kind of it.
Go up the tower, right? Because the boss is at the top of the tower. That's kind of it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's all you need. It's a simple story, but it's done well. Good action scenes, and Dredd's an absolute badass. And, you know, Carl Urban's not so vain that he has to take his helmet off so you can see his gorgeous face, whereas that was all about, you know, that's all Stallone wanted to do. Is like, yeah, I'm Sylvester Stallone. People need to see me.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the cardinal rule of Judge Dredd. You know,
Carl Urban, I had no idea that was the role that he was perfect for, but he was really good.
He was great.
Have you seen him in The Boys at all?
Yeah. Butcher is also
good in that, really good. He's a good actor. This is the thing, but he's so wasted in things, like completely wasted in the Star Trek movies. He never gets to do anything.
Doom movie. Did you see that? Doom? It was great, I swear.
Doom?
Yeah.
Oh, from like 15 years ago.
Yeah, The Rock. Yeah, so good.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I remember that one.
Bad. It is really bad.
Oh, what a film. Optimus Jedi says, was Daniel Craig's accent as bad as it sounded in the trailer? Also, there was a lot made about the characters being Trump supporters. Does that play out? Yeah, that absolutely does play out.
Oh, yeah. Really weird.
Yeah. Also, about his accent, I don't really know how to quantify it. It's kind of a joke accent, but I mean, it could work for you, I guess.
Yeah.
Not coming from the Deep South, I couldn't vouch for its authenticity, but it sounds... Yeah, it sounds way over the top.
Well, I mean, it's said in the film, he sounds like Foghorn Leghorn. It's like, well, gosh darn, what are we doing today? That sort of shit.
Yeah. And I think that's always one of the hallmarks of movies like this, isn't it? The detective or the sleuth has always got to be kind of quirky and different from everyone else and a bit eccentric. And that's how they do it in this one. So again, it's just the same kind of cliched stuff that you expect in a movie like this. It's all there. And this is an example of it. There's a good point here from Sideburns. If Marta watches actors saying lines in a film, does she throw up? Awkward. That's a good point. They are lying.
The film never shows her throwing up as a result of someone else lying. It only could be inferred that that's possibly how it works.
Yeah. Because it could be that she doesn't necessarily know if they're lying. But if she did, would it trigger her?
Yeah, the thing, I don't know. And of course, there are plenty of movies that you watch a character be dishonest, so I wonder if she can deal with that.
Just like, yeah, a trip to the movies could be an unfortunate experience with her. Fucking stop throwing up! Britain Swickard says, a Scotsman, a Welshman, a German, and a dog? Nah, it'll be fine. Laughing Karoo, my favorite part of the movie is the fact that Ryan subverts expectations by making the obvious killer the killer. Who saw that coming?
I think he may have thought that the thing there is like he's a reverse red herring or something. It's like you thought he was the one, I thought I was telling you he was the one, and then it kind of wasn't, but also it was.
Well, yeah.
Okay.
Nice one, Ryan.
Haha.
He got it. He nailed it.
Calamity Joan. Daniel Craig being a meh detective makes sense when it's revealed Chris Evans hired him on a whim after seeing an article. Well, I guess, but he kind of needs him to put it together because he needs, in his mind, based on what he knew at that point, he needed Daniel Craig to figure out that, Harlan had been overdosed and that Marta was to blame for it.
That was Ransom's goal, right?
Yeah. But then it shouldn't really have required a detective. Oh, all it required was the toxicology report, which the police should have just been doing themselves.
And they had already begun to investigate it anyway. And what? That's why they had to burn down the building.
Yeah. So what was the point of hiring him then?
What was the point of him hiring?
What's the point in this movie?
I don't know.
I don't want to think about the movie anymore, but that's a pretty big fucking issue.
Because that is literally the only reason he's there. It's just to make sure that Marta is implicated as having killed him either accidentally or through negligence or whatever.
He implicates himself by doing that, remember, because Daniel Craig is pretty much only interested in figuring out who hired him in the movie. That's about it.
Yeah.
Figures out pretty quickly that Marta's tied to it, but he's like, no, that's not the interesting part. If she is the one who killed him, and she's clearly a good person, so it was by accident, then who hired me? And that's what keeps him going throughout the whole fucking thing. So if he'd never hired him in the first place, he probably would have been better off.
In fact, she would have had no clue that they were kind of onto it, because the police would have just run their toxicology report. It would have shown up that she... Well, in fact, it wouldn't. No, fuck.
It must be halfway decent if you can spend longer talking about the movie than its runtime.
I'm going to assume that that's a joke comment.
Because, holy shit. How long have we talked about TLJ across these 2 years? 3 years? It's not a great movie, FYI.
That's the hallmark of Rian Johnson movies. You can spend days picking them apart, yeah.
Because his construction of movies, because I already know this from little behind the scenes things, the way he does it, he scribbles in loads of different notebooks, and then one notebook has his timeline in the film, and then he sort of just brings all of that to a script eventually. And apparently it took 7 months to write Knives Out, which was really disappointing to hear that it took him 7 months. I was like, oh. I like to believe that anybody with enough time can make something great, and I wouldn't like to think it took 7 months to make what we saw. In terms of script.
Yeah. That is a long time.
I would hope someone rushed and they were I'll pop this out in 2 weeks. I'd be like, oh, okay.
Really doesn't seem clever, and it doesn't seem like there was someone there to... Well, maybe there was. Maybe there was someone there to say, actually, this is a problem. This is a problem. This doesn't work. This doesn't make any sense. This requires teleportation. And he just never cared, which makes sense with what I know about him. He just doesn't care if it doesn't make sense. He doesn't care if it's contradictory to what we know. He doesn't care if it is an extreme contrivance. You got to get that tiny little payoff regardless of context.
Get them emotions going. Yeah. As the great Just Right said, you should be focused on emotional resonance, not intellectual satisfaction.
Which is something that stupid people say.
Yep, it's something I'd frame about a wall because it's so fucking, it reveals a lot about your perception on writing, that humans don't get satisfied from things locking into place and making sense. They only get satisfied from the bright colors and the crying and the shouting.
And if that was the case, Batwoman would be the best show ever.
As a great reviewer said, just pretend that you like it. Tell yourself that you like it, and then away you go. Perfect.
Such great advice. Because someone might assume that we're quite cynical to listen to our takes on movies from, but at least we're not selling you that garbage. Like, they just like it, okay? It's like, okay.
This is why we can refer back to other movies which did it successfully and say, look, here, there's a good example of how you can write a tight, you know, script that works and it's not full of holes. You know, it can be done, and we love to praise it when it happens. It just doesn't happen very often now.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't point it out, what's the point in even talking about films?
And it's why we can run any movie, for the most part, some, you know, to differing degrees, and it'll sort out objective, subjective, and it'll get our little analysis at the end. You could do this with everything. You could apply the standard to everything.
Structurally, nothing's working in Knives Out. It's just like, yeah, so this sucks. Like, there wasn't that moment where, like, what is a great scene from Knives Out?
where Marta vomits in Chris Evans' face. It was glorious.
If I had to say what was my favorite scene while watching,
I mean, I know what I would pick. And it wouldn't be an ironic thing.
Let me.
Should I go first?
I like the scene with Harlan and Marta playing their game and just chatting.
Yep, that was my choice.
Yeah.
It was casual. They were just chatting. He was throwing in some complaints about his family, I think, in there, while also having a fun little back and forth. And their dialogue did make it feel as though there was a history between them.
Yeah.
I would agree with that.
But that's
and you've got Christopher Plummer just being an excellent actor, you know?
Yep.
Yeah, that's kind of... Oh, remember the scene where Marta learns that her buddy Meg sold her illegal immigrant mom out to the rest of the family to be used against her? And she's like, no, it's okay.
Yeah, it's okay. Well, no problemo. Okay. Give me a hug.
No worries. It's fine. There's nothing wrong with what you did.
I don't want to understate it. That might be the most frustrating thing for me in the whole movie, because she just endangered your mother quite significantly for her own personal gain, and you are just like, eh.
That's okay.
There was another scene that followed on from that, which I don't think we've discussed in this, but when Walt tries to threaten Marta by saying, look, this is going to cause a lot of problems for you about the immigration issue, you're going to need some good lawyers to get you through this and to make it go away, and I can help you, as long as you like help me out, I can make sure you get the lawyers you need and everything will go away. And she's like, well, I've got your inheritance, so I can afford all the fancy lawyers that I need, so I don't need you at all. Bye. Yeah. It's like, that's just a character being, again, extremely dumb and not foreseeing the obvious result of what they've just said.
Well, it's also, and I think they do this essentially throughout the film, Walt is a character that you kind of like, he seems kind of like he could be a good guy. Same for the daughter of the parasite woman. Kind of could be good people. Then you have that scene with him, which basically confirms, yeah, he's not a good guy. And then you have the scene where she sells out her mother, so you're like, oh, she's not a good guy. It's like, they're all just terrible. Okay, fine.
They're all just terrible.
They're all money grubbing as fuck.
They're all pages of the script. They're all just terrible.
Because of course Walt is like, you know, it's you actually going to give it up? And she's like, well, this is what Walt wanted. And then he goes, sorry, not what Walt wanted, what Harlan wanted. And he was just like, well, I mean, you know, come on.
Fucking idiot. Salad King says, "Hail, Lord, drinker, cracker of cans, breaker of bottles, popper of corks, lover of loose women, I am actually, and king of alcoholics, Hail Rugleton, Mugglesbury, and Muto, Halo 3 PC.
Hello, okay. Hello.
Hi.
Wake Robin, love your content, drinker, a breath of fresh air in our current age of woke culture. Also a fan of MauLer/EFAP, good rap for sure. Did anyone struggle to be objective watching Knives Out because of Moonface Johnson's work with TLJ?
No. Didn't have any trouble. It just sort of informed a lot of the stuff that we witnessed. We're like, oh, yeah, this is Rian Johnson.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's, for me, it was an interesting one because it established a pattern with him, because I didn't have anything to compare really TLJ to. But then when I watched Knives Out and I saw a lot of the same habits that he demonstrated in TLJ with script writing, I was like, oh, okay, you know, this wasn't, you know, TLJ wasn't just a fluke. This is how the guy operates. This is how he writes.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I said to you guys before we started watching it, it's like, I expect it to be a meh sort of film. I think it's going to be like 5 out of 10.
That's what I was expecting.
And yeah, it kind of was. Like, I didn't think it was going to be terrible. I didn't think it was going to be great. It was just bleh.
I mean, I'd go as far as saying it's terrible. I don't know if I'm alone on that, but I just, like, I don't think we should be calling this okay.
No, it's not okay. It's pretty bad. Especially, like, now that we talked about it more.
Do you honestly think this hits par? Do you think this is like a 5 out of 10?
Probably not. I mean, from a point of view of just watching it and letting it wash over you and not thinking too much about it, you'd get away with 5 out of 10. If you do what we've done and pick it apart and think about it for more than 3 seconds, yeah, then it falls apart and the writing's like a 2 out of 10. So, yeah, I don't know where I stand with it. Ultimately, I got to the end of it and I was just like, I saw a film. That's all I can say about it, really. It made no impression. No Name gave me a super sticker and so did Max Damage. So thanks very much. Lady Squiffington, what's worse, Knives Out or The Unicorn Store? I couldn't tell you because I haven't seen Unicorn Store.
I think Unicorn Store makes more sense than Knives Out.
No idea.
Rags, what do you think?
Oh, I'm sorry, what?
What's better, Knives Out or Unicorn
Store? Unicorn Store. At least, I think in Unicorn Store, it's more fascinating and bewildering to where it's more entertaining. If we're talking subjectively, I definitely would rewatch Unicorn Store again. Without checking runtime, I might just go with whichever one's shorter, but I'd probably watch Unicorn Store again. It's just weirder and kind of more interesting because of its terrible weirdness.
It runs smoother than Knives Out does.
Yeah, I agree. Plus, Samuel L. Jackson is trying his heart out, and
he's flamboyant and bombastic. You get that, at least.
There's probably some good clips and bits of him saying some things, but even like if we're getting objective about plot, then it might even be more secure in its own universe as well.
Unicorn Store doesn't suffer anywhere near as much as.
I'm trying to think of examples where it would totally fall apart. A lot of this is, you know, based off memory, and my brain does try to block out these kinds of experiences. I think it does actually. I think Unicorn Store is actually a better written film than Knives Out in terms of its consistency and its own internal logic.
It flopped, didn't it, Unicorn Store?
I bet most people don't know it exists. I can double check, though. Unicorn Store box office. If it was a box office. Let's see. Unicorn Store. Let's go to reception. Let's see. Release. It was revealed that Netflix picked up the distribution rights. So... Right. Yeah, I guess it was just Netflix. I'm curious because the reception was
seriously made the money it cost back.
Yeah, I doubt a lot of people were flocking to Netflix so that they could watch Unicorn Store. let me go to Unicorn Store Rotten Tomatoes. So 65 on the tomato meter. So this is certified fresh, by the way, by critics.
Oh, that means a lot, yeah.
Audience rating, it only has 1,573 reviews or ratings, and it's 41% positive. So, and I suspect that the kind of person who would watch Unicorn Store would be the kind of person, you know, Brie Larson, it's very odd kind of. When you look at the cover of it and you see stills from it, you wonder what's the appeal.
It's quirky Brie Larson being quirkitisms.
It's quirky Brie Larson. It's terrible. I would absolutely watch it again before he knives out.
That's the best review. It's terrible. I would absolutely watch it again rather than Knives Out.
I would rather put Knives in Knives Out. Oh, shit.
Zero Gravitas says, joining late because I wanted to watch the movie first. Holding the four of you responsible for the 2 hours I won't get back. Damn you all. Well, yeah, we're not going to get those 2 hours back either, but we had to do it.
I'd lose four.
Yeah. That is dedication, honestly. Doing it twice. Alan Coleman says, how about that awkward as hell political discussion? What was the point of that? And who was supposed to come across as an idiot? All of them, I think.
All of them. Yeah, they're all played off as being idiots. However,
there's a comment about that. Near the end of the film, she says, wow, you're like a shit detective. And he says, well, in fairness, you're a shit killer. And again, it reminds me of the Rian Johnson. Like, we got the trifecta at this point, because in Looper, you have the comment where it's like, stop thinking about it. In this film, it's like, lol, we're all fucking dumb. And then in TLJ, it's because the themes are what saved that movie. You have Yoda looking at the screen with a thumbs up, saying what the theme is, the means by which to defend the movie from anybody pointing out how nonsense it all is. He likes his meta commentary to defend his films ahead of time, I suppose.
Yeah. And I think it's just, you know, it's this sort of political fetishism, the fetishism that Rian seems to have, that he has to work into every movie. And, you know, it will get you a lot of, you know, plaudits from professional reviewers and journalists and stuff. And I think that's what they kind of rely on for word of mouth then for movies like this. It gets that buzz going and away you go. But yeah, it felt so unnecessary, so pointless, and just really awkward.
Because if he had done the same thing except gone the other direction with it, it would have been labeled as it would have been all about the film's politics. They wouldn't have talked about the plot. It would have been all about how divisive it is and how it's very, very vitriolic in its message and that sort of thing. Assuming it was even allowed to be made at all with those kind of politics and that kind of place, you know, the Hollywood and the people he knows and stuff of that nature. But as it is, it's totally fine to make that sort of thing with, you know, these sorts of stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, if this was a film that took place in Mexico, in some, you know, villa in the, you know, the gorgeous desert, and it was a white person who was, you know, Marta's character, and all of the, you know, Hispanic people were the terrible, horrible ones, and all the same messages and subtle nods were the same, just flowing in an opposite direction in an opposite place, then there's no way it would have been, no way that would have been made.
Yeah.
The idea that the message is that a white person comes into a non-white place and he's the good one and the other ones are bad, and he gets to have all the stuff at the end, and he proves that they don't actually deserve all the stuff that they have and they want to protect. There's no way that movie would have been made. This is definitely something that only flows in one direction.
Yeah. Yeah, and it never gets called out. It's great. Louis the Plank says, wait, there's a character who throws up when she hears a lie. I have a similar condition where I throw up every time I hear a bad plot device. Well, I've done a lot of...
Don't watch Rian Johnson movies.
Yeah, yeah, keep a bucket handy.
We've probably triggered a lot of spewing in the past couple of hours.
Oops.
Alan Coleman says, didn't just write like this movie. Yeah, apparently he did.
Of course he did. Because he was emotionally satisfied. He didn't think about how characters have to basically teleport in order to have the plot work.
If he was here right now and I said, just right, did you find Knives Out to be emotionally resonant? He'd say yes. And then I'd say, did you find it intellectually satisfying? He'd say yes. And I'd be like, whoa, here we go. Let's have a conversation, John.
In a what?
Intellectually satisfying. That's the two things, right? And I guarantee you he thinks this movie is actually clever.
Sure he does. He'll fucking clap at anything because he liked TLJ. He thought that was so fucking impressive the way that they did all that.
And you prove to him, like, none of it makes any fucking sense, he would then just you know.
Oh, well, I mean, it doesn't matter anyway. It
still worked emotionally.
Yeah, it doesn't matter anyway.
And has he always been like this? Has that been his sort of consistent line? It's all about the emotion and not the, the consistency.
It all changed with TLJ and the conversation Wolf and I had with him, because Wolf was a big fan of his channel, which was pretty crazy because I'd never even heard of him at that point, I don't think. And he made a video series that explains how The Hobbit is terrible. He's made one for, I think it was Game of Thrones season 7 at that point, and how nonsensical. Do you remember the wall episode? Like, that was the one that a lot of people were really fucking annoyed with because it made no fucking sense at all. So he was very much on that train. And then when Wolf highlighted that to him, he was like, yeah, but, and the famous line where he said, if you do that, if you like explain how something sucks, then you're kind of taking enjoyment out of the world.
Oh, for God's sake.
And then season 8 comes out of Game of Thrones, and Just Right did the exact same fucking thing as he did with season 7. He was like, wait a minute, dude, you're taking enjoyment out of the world. Stop.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. I mean, is it like a progressive thing for him? Is he just like, well, the politics of TLJ were right, so I'm just going to support it no matter what?
Well, it doesn't. It shouldn't be.
I can believe him liking it, and that's it.
One should imagine that it should have no bearing on your politics, whether or not your position is. Art should be emotionally satisfying, and that should be, you know, that's duh. But it just so happens, you know, one notices tendencies and patterns with people. The people that we cover, those big names that are terrible at what they do, one does notice they are very, very left, very progressive. It's an observation that could be made.
I don't think that came up in his review of it because he was sticking to genre, but I'm sure that that's something he would say is valuable about Knives Out. He certainly thinks about TLJ, at least I don't have a reference for that, but I'm pretty sure he does. I think he's pretty much to the point where he's not going to talk to us ever again because of that debate. And, I imagine it's partially because TLJ drew some weird lines online. If you're on the hater side of it, then your politics can be assumed, and I guess you could say the same in reverse. It's really weird because I've only ever really been tied to how much it doesn't make any sense, not it necessarily its politics. I even made that clear in my videos on it. I was like, whether or not you think capitalism is gay, Ryan did a really fucking weird job of trying to explain that or criticize it.
Yeah.
Also, I think he sends a very broken message. Like, someone who's very anti-capitalist may not be cool with the idea of, yeah, destroy everything and everyone. It's like, yeah, maybe that, maybe not that. Maybe we should try and change the system from within rather than break everything.
Oh, man. Tesla Volta Games says, the film is about migrants and how they deservedly... sorry, I'm just trying to reword this to something that makes sense. The film is about migrants and how they deservedly should take the power away from established ethnic power. It was Rian Johnson's response to the response to The Last Jedi.
I could absolutely see that. And there's definitely, if you were going to make a review or an analysis of this movie just purely based on those politics, there's a lot of stuff that you could draw from. Mm. We didn't miss it. It was really kind of on the nose, a lot of the stuff they did. You have a lot of fuel, a lot of ammunition to make that analysis video if you wanted to.
It seemed almost petulant, some of it. Just like, people have been mean to me and I don't like them. They're mean poopy pants and they're alt-right and all the rest of it. And I'm just going to like make fun of them in this movie. And, you know, when you're reacting like that in such a childish way, because people didn't like what you did previously, it betrays your lack of maturity as an artist and a director, you know?
How do I mute this thing?
on the bottom left. Oh, there you go.
Ding, 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 ding.
That's what walls are there for, just throw it against it.
Shut up!
It's just... Ryan always seemed like kind of a prickly sort of person who just, I think, criticism would really bother him. Like, as much as he would refuse to acknowledge any criticism of his work,
a clip
deep down, I think it really does bother him, and this is his way of, like, retorting about it.
Have you found any of the criticisms valid? Nope.
Wow. What an amazing response. Just like, yeah, right. my work is above criticism. What a response. Yeah.
I need to head out, so I will catch everybody later for our next movie get together.
Mm-hmm.
We ever do cool, one again.
What's next, Rags? It could be another Rian Johnson flick. Who knows?
Well, the very next comment here is rip Looper apart. But no, seriously, man, I appreciate you coming into this this chat tonight. It's been good to talk to you again. And
yeah, it's a good movie to talk about. It was a learning experience all around. I hated it. So, whatever movie we bisectalize next, I will see you then. Thanks much.
All right, thanks, dude.
Bye, Riggs.
Bye.
Go away now. Cool. Well, should we start talking about Rags now that he's gone?
Yeah, he's a dingus.
Right, what have we got here? Alan Coleman. Finish Rian off, rip Looper apart. We may just end up talking about that sometime. Miranda Sinistra. Knives Out felt like a mockery of the whodunnit genre. It didn't even feel like a mockery, really. It just felt like a kind of weak, pale imitation for me. It was trying to copy all the beats of it, but just not really having much original.
I don't care. Like if someone's like, oh yeah, how do you think it stacks in this? I'm just like, it doesn't make any fucking sense. So like, I don't know. It's just like, I just feel like you have to deal with that. Whatever you're trying to do genre wise, like there's no genre that is benefited by being nonsensical. I just stuck back at that point. Like, how does it fit in there? How does it do with that? It's like, I don't know. It does all the stuff you kind of expect, but it just does it really poorly.
Yeah. So it's just... Yeah, like I said earlier, when I got to the end of it, I just felt nothing. I was like, there's been a black hole in my life for 2 hours.
And it's weird. Go ahead, sorry.
No, I was going to say as well, like, if you guys ever do release the audio of us, like, doing the watch of it, there's just like big long spells of like, 5 or 10 minutes where nobody's saying anything because there's literally nothing interesting to talk about in the film. It's just people walking around doing stuff. There's nothing going on.
Yeah. And especially when you get to the end and you have like all this info or don't have the info, whatever you want to say. And you get to the thing where he all wraps it up and it's like, oh, it's going to all make sense now. And then you listen and it's like, oh, that's it.
I mean, when
is there something else coming up? No.
When you do shit like the Hugh thing, and you have him being like, yes, I killed her, but I guess I didn't kill her. Oh, really top tier writing right here. I can't even take it.
It's just so disappointing because you pay attention to everything, and it's like, oh, yeah, I'm going to see if I can connect the dots myself. And then, stupid shit like the Hugh. It's like, no one said Hugh to him before. Ever. Why would she on her dying words do that? Like, it makes no fucking sense.
Yeah. It was kind of satisfying watching Chris Evans just sitting there smirking at everyone, going, you can eat shit and you can eat shit. And just like going through everyone.
He was the first proper character I was liking at that point in the scene, because I didn't know any reason to hate him yet. So I was just like, hey, he's kind of fun. And all these people are horrible, so I'm cool.
And, it wouldn't have been more interesting, like, he's the black sheep of the family and stuff, but ultimately he kind of comes good.
He is a good person, and he's a black sheep, because the rest of them are fucking assholes. And, of course, he's unpopular with them.
Yeah. But that'd be smart. King Bash says everyone should stand hoodwinked instead. Hoodwinked. Anyone?
Sorry, what was the question?
It says everyone should stand hoodwinked instead.
Oh, is let me check, sorry. Wait, that's a fucking the animated movie. I thought it was. Is that a whodunnit? I can't remember. I remember one of the songs from that movie, weirdly, but
I haven't seen it myself.
What was that?
It's like an animated movie from 2005. I remember it.
Fair enough. What's the German title? Yep, never heard of it.
Miranda, I'll move on from that one in that case. Miranda Sinistra, also any nurse or anesthetist would say that it would be utter insanity to rely on using the weight of a medication to tell the difference between two. Yeah, you read the labels. I would think anyone would do that.
If we had five nurses confirm it's a thing they do, I would still be in disbelief. I'd be like, you
really?
that seems ridiculous.
John Ellis Bush. Well, how bad was it? Well, as we've established, pretty bad.
I'm surprised that no one in the EFAP community wanted to tell Rags and I that one of the reveals is misunderstanding you for Hugh, or reverse that. I'm surprised this film managed to, like, the theory that's going for a friend of mine is that nobody in the EFAP community watched it because it's by Rian Johnson. And I was like, oh, that could be it, yeah. No one told it. It's bad, I'm surprised.
Yeah, there's a good point that someone's made in the chat, actually. With a normal mystery story, the core of the central story thread is an inquiry thread, so it's the mystery. But a third of the way in, it's revealed exactly what happened, so this film loses its core, which it kind of does. Like, you actually get the chain of events that triggered all of this.
Well, the argument there would be that it turns from a whodunnit, like, literally, into a more suspense-focused, like, thriller of will our protagonist who didn't mean to kill the person get away with it? Who knows?
It's like a whodunnit.
That's supposed to be how he's playing with the genre, by the way, which is just not where I would place my criticisms. That's not where I'd like to focus. I just want to focus on how nonsensical everything is and how all of his payoffs destroy themselves and how the premise kills itself. Like, there's so much wrong with this.
Yep. Dante Inferno, buy yourself something cheap. Well, I might be able to get a dance off Tatiana for that, so thank you.
Sweet.
She's pretty cheap. C'est moi. I gave up on Star Wars after TFA, but I enjoyed this movie. It was fun and interesting and a treat to watch. Daniel Craig's accent was atrocious, though. Are you sure it was fun? Yeah, I mean, I guess, you know, you can apply whatever criteria you want to it, but when we're sitting here kind of, when we're just trying to discuss one plot point in the movie and we end up diverging on like 20 different paths for like a good half hour about all the other problems that we encounter just to get to that point, I think you can see that the issues that the script has got, like, it's full of holes. And this is kind of like a donut, yeah. Like a donut that's been shot with a shotgun or something, and it's full of pellets.
So for those who don't know, there's this scene where he's talking about how this case is like a donut because he has everything except there's a hole in the middle, and he says that hole is who hired him, right? And you're like, okay, I can kind of follow that. Later on, he says to our protagonist, yes, the case is a donut, but within the donut hole is another donut with a hole inside that donut, and the donut and the hole that is our case fits perfectly inside the hole in that donut. And it's like, this is not funny. Like, this is just nonsense. The fuck?
They just stop.
I think that's when you know you've taken your analogy to its logical conclusion. Like, just stop it.
Well, there's someone is spamming in your chat. Someone added me. It's nothing I can do about it.
We can't do anything.
All right, hold on.
Apparently someone would be like Platoon 1986.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, we'll fucking review it just to shut you up.
We're doing it right now. I think it was good. All right, next question.
Hold on, I'm just going to mute this person.
Metal is the voice of the people, though.
There we go. Right. Oh. But yeah, I think this person was probably right to give up on Star Wars after TFA. It's a good call. Dr. Martin Luther Pepe. Hey, I was just enjoying EFAP 95 with a glass of Highland Park, and now I stumble upon this. It's double the tisms. Hello, Metal.
Hi.
Yeah, you're getting your fix of EFAP-type stuff tonight. Doomsday Kingdom Army. Let's talk something fun like The Boys Season 2. Yeah, the trailer's dropped for that. So.
Oh, really?
I think so, yeah. I'm pretty sure, like, it was a while back, actually. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm looking forward to it. The first season was great. It was a great new take on the superhero genre, and it was just nice to see the superheroes all being complete assholes, especially Homelander. I think he's my favorite. There were so many Homelander memes doing the rounds. It was great. I think my favorite one was like a person drowning and it's just like their hand reaching out of the water and Homelander just comes in and high fives them, doesn't help them, and just goes, "You're the real hero."
Yeah, I enjoyed the boys.
Hold on, I just refreshed my super chats here, so I'm just trying to catch up with where I was at. Oh yeah, here we go. Ivan Evans gave me a sticker. Thank you. Lady Ladjack, based on the Keystone Cops, I thought we were going to find out that he never actually died. That must be Harlan. And he was just pranking everyone with Ransom's help. I actually thought that for a while, that it was some elaborate ploy on his part to see who in his family was actually loyal and deserving of the inheritance.
Yeah. But
it never went anywhere. Say,
when they show that she killed him, well, he killed himself after she poisoned, blah, blah, blah. I remember on my first watch through, I was like, I'm assuming there's more to this because that's. That's a little bit lame. Like if that's what the story is. But again, lame isn't, you know, like I wouldn't, if the movie made complete sense, like I wouldn't be saying like, yeah, but I thought it was lame that I was just like, it's fine. I was like, wow, that's what you went with. Okay.
Trying to say this person's name, Jevlum. Anything worth discussing from the Knives Out deleted scenes? Hello, Metal Rags, Drinker, and Longman. I've not seen any of the deleted scenes because I want to see as little of this movie as possible, to be honest with you. So,
pretty much,
there's nothing I can really discuss on that one. I'm trying to imagine what you would want to add in that would add more length to this film. I mean, yeah, some flashbacks or some context for a lot of the decisions would be good, or setting things up in advance a little bit better. Nonya Bidness says, Rian Johnson is insanely good at making movies that Jay Bowman would love. Fair enough. Yeah,
did RLM do a Knives Out video? I kind of, if they have, I need to see that because I think I would have avoided it.
Yeah, I think they probably would have done, wouldn't they? It was fairly big when it came out. Seems like the sort of thing they would cover. Taylor Ramirez, Rian, you named your villain Ransom. JFC, why do people give you money to make movies? Good question.
JFC's Jesus fucking Christ, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I agree. Ransom's not much of a... First of all, it's not much of a name. Secondly, it's not much of a ambiguous name. It's more of a, oh, he's like a bad person? Because ransoms aren't usually associated with good things.
No, exactly. You might as well call them Maverick or something, you know. Eskimo Phono, the drinker compares sounds like a fun idea. Yeah, I mean, it's something that I kind of do in the context of my reviews anyway. Like when I'm talking about a really shitty movie, especially a modern one, I'll usually compare it to something good in the past. Like when I did Terminator Dark Fate, I was like, okay, these are all the terrible things that happen in this movie. I'm going to compare them to something like T2, which is really good and smart, and compare the characters and stuff. This is why one movie worked and the other one didn't. But yeah, I suppose if I was to make a proper video around that concept of just taking two films like Jurassic Park and Jurassic World, yeah, it could be fun. The original Black Irishman donated $5, so thank you. Ivan Petrescu, Dredd was killed by timing. After Robocop and Total Recall, people didn't want to see another remake.
Well, maybe it shouldn't have come out now, then, I guess, because, you know, I don't know. I don't know what would have done it, but certainly wasn't the quality of it. I wouldn't pin it on that, I guess.
I always had a feeling that the marketing was wrong. I don't know if I'm just guessing on this one, but I don't remember it getting much coverage, and it just kind of like...
I definitely checked it out because of word of mouth, not because of trailers or anything.
Yeah. And it's like it just kind of appeared in cinemas and, you know, people could go see it or not if they wanted to. And yeah, it just totally relied on word of mouth and it just wasn't enough. And it's a shame. I mean, I suppose Carl Urban's not a huge star, so there wasn't a huge draw to it. But yeah, such a shame. Cyan God says, Master Drinker, Lord Mauler, would you guys be up to doing RoboCop trilogy and remake review of such an iconic character? Wow. I mean, the only RoboCop that was actually good was the very first one. Like, the second one was trash. The third one, they just completely lost the plot with it and it became like a parody. And I've not even seen the remake. I'd never wanted to see it.
I think I saw the remake, but I remember finding it pretty well. I mean, I've forgotten most of it, so that tells you everything.
Yeah. I mean, Paul Verhoeven, like, in his prime when he was doing these kind of satirical movies with real bite to them, he was great. Like, that's what you got from RoboCop. But, yeah, then they just kind of completely lost the thread of what made it the first one such a compelling film. King Bash says the first Scooby-Doo movie had a better twist, probably. Despadoodle, I remember the boys TV show and how they butchered the story and characters, slap in the face to the source material. I mean, I can't vouch for that because I've never read the boys comic, so I don't know. Same. I just know that the TV show I thought was pretty good. I don't know how authentic it is.
Yeah, I mean, I really enjoyed the show itself. I have no idea about the source material, but I don't know, I think they did a good job with everything so far. Not everything, but most of it.
Mm-hmm. Snell World, that movie was mentally challenged. Knives Out is a bad version of the movie Clue from the 1980s. I've never seen Clue, so I couldn't speak to that. Have you guys seen it at all?
No, I don't know. That'd be something I might consider watching then, out of curiosity.
Yeah, no, I haven't.
The Fez Man. If you like musicals, I recommend Curtains. It's a murder mystery play. Jason Manford starred in the UK one. Please review Clue next. Okay. I mean, it'd be great to go see a play. You remember when we could go places in public and like go into indoor venues and do stuff?
I do remember that.
That was nice. I like that. You know. I think they're actually opening the cinemas again here, but there's fuck all on. It's just like old movies that came out like 10 years ago. Yeah, I'm kind of looking forward to when new things start coming out again and I can actually review new stuff because I'm kind of just going through back catalogs here.
Yeah. Instead with you're reviewing Knives Out.
Yeah.
They have postponed Tenet?
Indefinitely.
Indefinitely?
Yeah.
I want to watch that one. I'm interested in what they do because I have no fucking clue what the movie's going to be about.
Neither do I. I know virtually nothing about it. Robbie Elkins donated $1. Yum Meat Mup. Don't know what you four are on about. Knives Out was the greatest whodunnit ever, and Rian Johnson is the greatest writer. Vomits violently. Nice one. Drunk 3PO. Cheers, my fellow drunk. Cheers to you, sir. I love your stuff. Sir Hi Guy, your amount and message will be public. Okay. You should probably have put something in there. Arnau Puig, I crossed our Rian Johnson in the streets of Mayfair last December. After some initial shock, I thought about saying how bad TLJ was, but decided not to stop him. What would you have done? He was really short in real life. I don't think I would have spoken to him.
I mean, if let's say you're sitting next to him on like a train and he says, you know, hello, how you doing? I wouldn't go to TLJ at all. I'd just be like, oh yeah, how are you? I'd probably be like, holy fuck, that's Rian Johnson.
Yeah. I mean, if I got into a conversation with him, like I met him at some party or something and the talk turned to TLJ, I would just, I don't know how I would even phrase it. I'd be like, are you genuinely happy with what you produced there? Or do you think like maybe you've made a mistake?
Like, can you believe how many people like went crazy over your movie? Like in both ways, like there's people out there who despise it, and there's people out there who adore it. I guess you must be pretty happy with that result. How have you found it? Do you find any of it is like helpful in terms of how you're going to make things next? Do you think you made any mistakes? You know, try and find a natural way to maybe getting to the interesting part that I want.
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess the fundamental question would just be to say why did you movie?
How did you get it? How did it happen?
It would be interesting. It would be great to have like an honest conversation about it, but it would never happen. Hi again, dudes, and Talking Dog. Thoughts on Clue? Yeah, as we were saying, none of us have watched it, I'm afraid, but everyone seems to be talking about it. Like,
do list since it's Knives Out relevant, I guess.
Yeah.
Put it on the list.
Yeah, I'll put it next to the 500 other movies that I need to watch or review. Mr. Cornbreads, Last of Us 2 or Ghost of Tsushima? Well, Last of Us 2 was kind of garbage, so I would definitely take Ghost of Tsushima over that. I haven't played it yet, but it's getting rave reviews, so
I haven't played any of those two, but I would just go personally just go for Ghost of Tsushima in general.
Yeah, Last of Us 2 is one of the most depressing games you could play. Everything's pointless, everyone's horrible. And everyone just loses everything. So
yeah, but I have like no investment in any of the Last of Us games, so I just wouldn't care about the second one, obviously.
Yeah. How have you been getting on, MauLer? Have you gotten on to 2 yet?
I just finished Last of Us yesterday, I think, and even did the DLC. I am fully contextualized on it now. I'm good to go for number 2. And many of the people in my chat have been begging me not to play it and begging me to play
it. Yeah.
Don't do it.
Thinking of starting Friday, because I think Wednesday we're going to be doing a stream, me and Rags, and we got Batwoman premiering, or Wrinkle in Time. I still don't even know which one of them I'm actually putting out, but yeah, stuff to come.
Again, immediately falls like, oh yeah, we watched that. Every time. I don't know.
When is season 2 of Batwoman scheduled for? Is it next year, I take it?
Yeah, but it could be late as fuck. Like, we don't really know. The only thing officially was like January, but I'm pretty sure that's nonsense now because they haven't even been able to start filming.
Yeah. It'd be interesting to see what they do with that. That's gonna be great. Wayne H says, isn't Knives Out just a weak remake or reimagining of Murder by Death? I couldn't tell you. Not seen it, I'm afraid.
Same.
Yeah, I haven't either.
Vash Stampede, thoughts on Harlan cutting off Walt for wanting to make money for him or leaving his money to the maid? Seemed a little far-fetched and mean to me.
I don't... he seemed to take pleasure in cutting them all out of his will, but I don't see why Walt is getting so much anger. Neither do I get why Linda's getting so much anger.
Mm.
Yeah, like neither... Like, Walt in particular has done nothing but help him, and he even expressed like regret for having held Walt back. And having him just running his business instead of creating his own books and stuff. So to then like cut him out for no apparent reason just seems really strange. It doesn't logically follow.
If the logic is you take away all of their help so that they can finally, you know, break out on their own, it's like, so why wouldn't that same logic apply to Marta then?
Yeah. And also, like, these people are, you know, his kids in particular are all in their 40s and 50s easily. Like, these aren't like young people who can now strike out into the world and make their way. Like, they are middle-aged people who've kind of, they've come as far as they're going to go realistically already. Like, you're just taking stuff away from them. You're not giving them new opportunities.
Walt's on a walking stick too.
Yeah. That's never explained, is it? Because he's wearing like a brace on his foot. Like, yeah, he's broken it or something.
He's just a character who has trouble walking. You're like, okay.
Yeah.
Was it specifically just to have that scene where he comes towards Marta and the editing zooms in on his walking stick as being like, oh my God, walking stick.
Probably. I mean, you know, Ransom's called Hugh just so you could have that line. So.
That's sad, isn't it? He probably wasn't called Hugh in the original draft. And then he was like, oh
shit.
He can say you did this, but it could mean... Hugh, oh, this is so good. He's going to be called Hugh now. Oh,
lucky me. Yeah.
You know what would be a great idea? James Prendergast says, thank you guys for covering Roundhead's latest abortion. After this released, everyone else seemed to love it, and I thought either I or the planet had gone mad. Yeah.
I'm right with you, man. Yeah. Honestly. After seeing it, I was fucking confused. I was like, wait, this is the movie that people said was like a at the very lowest, like a 5-6 sort of thing. Like, man.
Yeah. It's odd. I mean, is it just, has there not been a good movie like this for a long time and people have just forgotten what they're meant to be like? And so they're like, oh, wow, it's a murder mystery and it's smart.
19 gave us a whole bunch of good ones. You had 1917, Ford v. Ferrari, Marriage Story, Parasite, Joker. Like, we had loads of good shit.
No, they were great movies, but none of them were murder mysteries. So had there just not been anything good in this genre for a long time and people have just kind of forgotten what good murder mysteries should be about? I don't know.
It's or is, like,
yeah, like, has Rian Johnson just got like the Steve Jobs reality distortion field going on where just, people just love what he does no matter what it is? Strange. Flubber USA rewatched EFAP 93. CV made 34 gay jokes and 11 HP references.
Oh, wow. Yeah, we didn't get a count on that. The guy we covered just kept making gay jokes. It was really weird.
Covering for something there, I suspect.
Well, that's the assumption. None of us really can conclude anything else. Which is like, it must be.
Well, it's good that you counted anyway. Dr. Smash, do these drinker podcasts count as EFAP EU? Moa, you'd probably have to answer that one. I don't know.
I mean, I don't even know what necessarily qualifies a thing for an EFAP EU, but if I put everything, if I did, like, if Rags and I pinned up on anything outside of EFAP and it ended up as EFAP EU, at that point I'd be like, oh, well, nah, go to Drinker's channel and check out anything that we're involved in. If that's your entry level to checking out his channel, you know, if you want us to be around, then it'll be a nice little gateway into watching his content. So I'd rather just leave it like that. The EU stuff, like, a lot of those videos are just videos that are lost to, you know, being deleted or videos. Like, some of it is, well, one of them right now is one of Metal streams, and of course it's just hard to get people to see some of that stuff because most people don't check out Twitch VODs. That's not something that many people do.
Mm-hmm.
It gets to be edited, so yeah, I don't know what requires it specifically, but I would imagine I would rather just send people here. I'd be like, go check out the thing we did with Drinker. Go.
Yep. I must admit, I love the EFAP wiki. Some great stuff in there. The epic battles that have taken place. Corey Capella, I love this every frame of drink. Yeah, I had to stay, like, oh. I say, I had to stay a bit more sober because when I'm running a stream, I end up having like three different screens going at the same time. So I'm trying to watch it and make sure nothing's falling apart. GD Chapel, don't spend it all in one place. Awesome entertainment for a Tuesday. Thank you. And Tuesday is a great day to have entertainment.
Yes.
Absolutely.
For you guys, it was the most important day of your life. But for me, it was Tuesday. let's see. Sorry, I'm just refreshing my super chat here. Whenever I do that, I always lose my place. Pisses me off. Yeah, there we go. Flubber 11, did you hear that Rian Johnson deleted his Twitter? Yeah, but I don't think it was deleted, or I don't think he did it. It was just, it got hacked or something.
That's part of the big hack thing, because he put out on his Knives Out Twitter that he's waiting to come back. He's just waiting for his account to be unblocked, I guess.
Yeah, I'm sure we all can't wait to hear what Ryan's got to say. there was rumors going around that, like, when this hack happened, basically the hackers were able to gain access to everyone's DMs as well. And apparently a lot of the senior people at Disney were panicking because they're like, delete your accounts. We don't want people to see these DMs. Which kind of makes it sound like there's an awful lot of sinister stuff in there that they don't want people to see. Be interesting to see what's actually going on there, but it'll probably never be seen. Flubber 11 says, Rich Evans dancing is legendary. Check out War of the Worlds 21. No, Wheel of the Worst, sorry. It took me a moment to tune into that.
Rich Evans dancing in War of the Worlds 21.
God, I think I've only watched one of those, like, Wheel of the Worsts of... yeah,
that's good.
Yeah, it's really entertaining.
Gogar, Hey there, my favorite internet people, working on another meme video at the moment with all four of you in it, probably going to be done by Friday or Monday. Well, nice. Excellent stuff. We're honored. Silo 101. DVD leak, Kennedy gone. Oh yeah, Doomcock's been at it again. Disney begs Lucas to come back after executives saw cut of episode 9. They had conditions to remake the sequels and three more. D says, yes, true. I can't see it, to be honest. I can see Kennedy leaving if before next year, but I don't think Lucas is going to come back because he's too fucking old to be doing this stuff now, surely. I mean, he's got to be about 80-odd now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they are not going to remake the sequels. Much as I would love them to, there is no way that they're going to go to the expense and the difficulty of trying to remake these three, trying to get, you know, Harrison Ford to come back. He's never going to do that. You know, probably Mark Hamill would. I'm sure he'd be up for it, but that's not enough.
Him as like, we're trying to correct this shit, man. We're gonna retell this story, and you pitch him a story that he really likes. I think he'd do it.
Yeah.
It's just it's a shame that it's come to that. Really, I think the only way they can do this, or they can somehow get it on track, is like get rid of Kennedy, get rid of Rian Johnson, bring in new executives to run Lucasfilm, and just kind of start afresh. I think trying to take it in a different direction, but I just don't think anyone's going to care.
Kind of evergreen in terms of money making, or at least it's going to take a while to kill it. So they have a chance to just, you know, kind of be like, okay, we fucked up. We're going to try again.
Yeah. Flubber 11 says Clue literally had different movie endings where the murderer was a different character each time, depending on where the theater was. Really?
Cool.
That's interesting.
I really hope that's fucking true. That would be awesome. How would you manage that? How would you implement something like that?
You're like, oh, I love Clue. I can't believe blah, 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 blah. And then you're like, wait, what?
Yeah.
That's not what happened.
I'll need to look that up, totally. Because Reasons says, Dread was screwed by reviewers and the marketing. The reviewers compared it to The Raid, saying it was the same thing. I enjoyed both. Yeah, I mean, it's a similar, like, the setup's, I guess, similar to The Raid, but it's a completely different movie. But yeah, they were both excellent. I mean, they're the same in the sense that, like, the character's stuck in a bad place that they need to escape from, but that's pretty much it. HiZap77 says, not saying the Family Guy who killed James Woods episode is better, but
I'm sure it is.
Just give me a second here. I think we're just about done, actually. Come on. Yeah, I think it's just a couple more. Right, John Orchard, what type of movie or genre do you want to see when we get back to normal? Honestly, at this point, I'd take anything.
Yeah, I've never been like too tizzy about that sort of thing. I'm just like, yeah, I'd like to see good anything. I don't like. Yeah, so I was like, we're going to see a fantasy, sci-fi, or whodunnit. I'd be like, I'm up for any of them. Which one's the good one?
Yeah, because I mean, they're still trickling movies out into like Netflix and stuff, but they're pretty much all garbage. Like, people have been asking me to review The Old Guard, like that Charlize Theron one. I've not seen it yet, but I'm tempted to because apparently it's meant to be trash.
What one is that, sorry?
Old Guard.
I've not heard of it.
So I think she's meant to be like the leader of some kind of like special forces group, but like it turns out that they're almost like immortal warriors that have been fighting for thousands of years. So they pretty much can't die no matter how badly damaged they get. So I guess it kind of eliminates the tension when no one can die. Bobo Yogi says, please do an overview of Mel Brooks films. Christ, yeah, that's going back a bit. People keep talking about Blazing Saddles for me to review. One day. Brett Cohen says, Drinker, with all the book money you'll earn in life, can RJ do part two, Knives In, based on you? We could all collectively say go away now. We'll see. I'll have my people talk to Ryan's people and we'll sort something out.
Yay.
Nice.
But that is actually it for the Super Chats. So we made it to the end. We survived Knives Out and we survived this stream. So well done to all of you. Oh, someone else has put one here. Thoughts on Wind River? I haven't seen it, so I can't answer that, I'm afraid. Sorry, Stephen Otten. Vinny, you guys
need to
it?
Ask different movies. I haven't seen any of those two. People asked about.
Always makes similar.
Yeah, you see.
Yeah, see, it always makes me feel bad when you get a super chat in and it's like, oh, what are your thoughts on this movie? And I'm like, I haven't seen it, so I have no thoughts. Sorry. But no, anyway. So as I was saying there, that does bring us to the end. I want to thank you guys for joining me for this kind of read through of it and trying to pick apart this nonsense movie. And thanks to everyone who donated all these super chats, everyone who's been keeping us going in chat, and everyone who's been watching tonight. I guess I was just going to ask, like, what are you gentlemen working on at the moment? What have you got coming up next?
To be confirmed. Not sure yet.
But playing it diplomatic.
Batwoman is on the way. Like, EFAP stuff is not a surprise. We've got a month from now, literally, the 22nd of August, is EFAP 100. Going to be a relatively long show. A bunch of people will be invited. Lots of things to be covered. It's going to be so exciting. Tune in.
Whoa.
Well, I mostly just stream on Twitch. Old gamerous. I recently re-uploaded my John Wick 3 analysis and put it on my archive channel because that one got nuked the first time I uploaded it on my nuke channel that I wanted to use only for the analysis stuff. But some scammer nuked it down, and I couldn't do anything about it. So that was cool.
Shit, man.
Yeah, but now I re-uploaded it on the archive channel. I think that's the one you linked below anyways. Yeah. Perfect. Thank you for that, by the way. And yeah, go check that out. It's not a super long man, but it's all right for my first try.
Good, you were wrong.
Yeah, if you want to know why John Wick 3 is bad, that's a good start, I would say.
Okay.
I'm planning to make a video on John Wick 2, but I'm currently moving into my new place. When I'm all settled there, I'll probably stop working on that one. And that's going to be out sometime in the future because I'm not doing this full time. I'm just doing this on the side, pretty much. So it's going to take a while because I have to balance real life and shit.
Yeah.
It's annoying.
real life sucks.
It does. Like, no one wants to pay me for not doing anything. It's kind of weird. But yeah.
Yeah.
That works. But yeah, but you can almost catch me daily on Twitch in the evenings. Just hanging out, talking to shit, hanging out.
What I'll do, when I re-upload this to my Critical Drinker Live channel, I'll put a link to your Twitch account so that people can get you there as well.
Cool.
But yeah, in all other respects, I believe we're finished. So thanks very much, everyone. And that's all we've got. So we're going to go away now.
Okay, goodbye.
Bye.